Hello and welcome to episode number 3 of Shockwaves. I'm one of your hosts, Rob Galluzzo from Blumhouse.com. With me, as always, is Mr. Elric Kane. How are you, sir?
I'm excellent. Drinking Red Stripe beer. Couldn't be better.
You see, you're drinking. We drink beer on this show, believe it or not.
Yeah, occasionally.
We're reformed.
And that third voice is our lovely host.
I'm drinking my version of beer, Diet Coke.
Diet Coke?
It is.
Diet Coke drinking Rebekah McKendry.
It's seriously like my poison. Like, I know it's not good for me, but I have
it's
one
all right,
a week.
Soda. We all have our vices.
Yeah.
Some of us, our vice is horror, and that's why you're here listening. Before we delve into the show, we're 3 episodes in, and we're terrible hosts because there's so many people that helped get the show off the ground that we've neglected to thank, and a lot of people have been asking us online. So really quickly, the opening theme music that you hear for every episode is from Greg Burkhart, who is one of our contributors at Blumhouse.com and also a very talented musician and composer. He did that piece of music. It's called Fantomatique. With his band Corvo. And if you recognize his name not from our website, it might be because he scores and does all the sound design for all of Drew Daywalt's short films, which, you know, if you're into horror shorts, you probably have at some point come across Drew's stuff. So thank you, Greg, for the music. It's awesome. We love it. Number 2, Mr. Aaron Crawford, a.k.a. Cavity Colors, is responsible for the Shockwaves logo. All 3 of us are big fans. I'm sure people listening probably buy Cavity Color stuff.
We all want t-shirts. Not we, all, we want trust, t-shirts.
We want t-shirts.
Part of the reason we went to Aaron is because we want his design of our logo on a shirt. Mm-hmm. And we don't know how to do that, but he does. So we're gonna keep bugging him to help us make shirts. So that's on the horizon. Thank you, Aaron Crawford. And also, really quickly, throw a thanks out to John Holland, who does a lot of graphics for us on the Facebook page. And right now, a gentleman named Eddie Dutra started a website called shockwavefilms.com, which catalogs by poster all the movies we've been mentioning these last few episodes.
By poster?
By poster.
That is crazy.
Yeah, Elric hasn't even been on the site
yet. Oh my gosh,
yet.
I haven't even seen some of the posters for some of the stuff we mentioned.
It's kind of weird. It's kind of weird seeing our show
in a visual form.
In visually by posters.
I think that's what's been missing.
Yeah.
We needed a
visual. Having just the words are great, but it doesn't grab you like a poster. That's awesome.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Good stuff,
Eddie
Dutra.
What's the website again?
Shockwavesfilms.com.
That's cool.
We had nothing to do with this, but we encourage and thank Eddie for setting it up. And while we mention that, when we were Killer POV, we had Jennifer Lovely and for a short period of time, Jess Hicks had cataloged all the movies we mentioned, and we posted them all as notes on our Facebook page. So that's just, you know, to us, it's amazing that people partake in the show in that way. They want to help. They want to help other people that listen remember some of the titles that we shoot out, because I know we talk about a lot. So thank you to all those people, and thank you guys for listening. That's the first order of business. Order of business 2.
Oh, there's a second.
There is news that dropped this week that we have to mention. So Blumhouse is doing a Halloween movie.
Yeah, our parent company has acquired rights to make Halloween, and Blumhouse is making Halloween, people.
I bet that was an easy deal to make. They just closed that like nothing.
No one else involved. It's just super quick. No moving parts there.
So what do we know? Any little basic tidbits?
We don't know much other than that Blumhouse is going to make it.
We know that John Carpenter's involved.
That alone is huge news. Mm-hmm. John has not been involved in the series since, I guess, 3 was the last one he had anything to do with.
Yeah.
So as far as we know, he's exec producing. He is consulting, which means whatever filmmakers they put in place, he will be working with them to figure out how to tackle Halloween. And most exciting, he's doing the score.
Yeah, that above all is very great. Yeah. I love that.
So it won't be his traditional remake model where he's playing a game, and in his own words, I stick out my hand, and they put money in it, and I keep playing my game.
He's going to have to step up and actually do a little bit of work, apparently.
Well, I've heard he's kind of getting re-energized because he's like become a rock star.
I can tell you about that.
Tell us a little about it.
I heard that the tour, that
I don't
the
get jealous
opening
easily.
Night was awesome.
Yeah, it's hard to get me jealous.
Well, here's the thing. He has not... kicked off the tour as of yet, including when this airs. He's getting ready to tour. I think it starts in June, and he does have an LA show, and I have tickets for it. What happened was very last minute, he announced what was being billed as a rehearsal show, just kind of a warm-up, if you will. And it was at a tiny club called The Bootleg, which I'd never heard of. It's about the size of my apartment. It's tiny. Oh, it's a tiny, tiny place. It's also directly across the street from the Blumhouse offices, so it's a convenient walk.
Wow. Which is kind of funny. I didn't know there was anything like really cool close to us.
It's the one
aside
thing.
Aside from the Smart and Final.
Yes, the Smart and Final. There's some meth centers and things along those lines. But next to the meth center.
Downtown LA.
Is a little club called The Bootleg where they do shows. And honestly, I didn't get tickets. This was it's a really small venue. Not a lot of people were able to get tickets. They were like $20, and it was announced and sold out right away. I have to thank Ryan Turek, who at the last minute had an extra ticket and brought me along with him. And I didn't expect much, because sometimes with rehearsal gigs, it's not like, you know, when you go on tour, you have a full elaborate setup with screens and lights and everything. I didn't think he was going to bother with that. I thought they were just going to play the music. I was wrong. It was the full-on show they are going to do.
Yeah, I saw that they had like film footage rolling behind.
Yeah, and that's kind of what I anticipated was, you know, he obviously has got his two solo albums, Lost Themes and Lost Themes 2. Now, this isn't a reflection of the tour. I don't know what they have planned for the tour. I would assume they'd have a longer time period. He actually did not play that much original music. It was a lot of the themes from his movies. And what was cool is when he played, and I'm going to keep this as spoiler-free. There was a lot of surprises in the set list, for example. So I'd rather you find that out for yourself. But what was fun is that clips from the movies play while he plays the theme. And, you know, he came out and opened with the Escape from New York theme while clips from Escape from New York played behind him. And me and Ryan noticed that I'd say 35 seconds into the first song, the entire place was going nuts. And Carpenter, who's usually fairly emotionless for the most part, he let out a laugh. Like, he uncontrollably let out a laugh. And me and Ryan looked at each other like, he can't believe this. And you know what? I kind of can't either. I never thought I'd live in a world where at this point in his career and life, he's a total rock star. He's going to, and that's the funny thing is, I expected to go see some of his music and some of his themes, but really getting to see the clips from his entire filmography while listening to the music, it's just a great celebration of his whole career. Like, that's what that night
is.
He's
going to have to change that famous quote where he's like, in England, I'm a filmmaker. In Europe, I'm an artist. In America, I'm a bum. Now it's going to be, in America, I'm a fucking rock star,
he
bitch.
He is. He's totally a rock star here. And I love that so much. So if it comes anywhere near you, any of you guys out there listening, you have to go see him.
Yeah.
No matter what.
I know I was out of town when the LA show was going to be, so I wish I'd gone to this one, but I'll find some way to get to one of
them. I think they added a second LA show, and he's going to be doing quite a lot throughout the whole summer. But yeah, I mean, just spectacular. Exceeded every expectation.
Well, we'll finish our Carpenter roundup, because my favorite podcast, besides the Projection Booth, is the Bret Easton Ellis podcast, even though I often largely disagree with a lot of it. That's half the joy of listening to the Bret Easton, because he has great guests and he's an interesting guy. John Carpenter popped up as the guest today, which was a surprise, and a lot of people were tweeting at me saying, did you know he's on the show? And I was like, yeah, I just listened to it at work today. We'll start with the downside. The downside is John doesn't get to talk till the 28-minute mark.
28 minutes.
And the whole show is only 60 minutes.
Right.
Usually they're two-hour podcasts. So I was a little surprised by that. Maybe that was the time that's on. It's mostly about Hollywood as a business model, a political correct model, hang-ups of Bret Easton Ellis were largely at the start. But there was a couple just really fun little nuggets that I was just going to bring up, still listen to it. One cool quote that I heard was, every good horror film is a catharsis of two things, being the victim and being the aggressor. And then as soon as Bret Easton Ellis said that, Carpenter goes, yeah, stop, because he was going to keep talking. He goes, no, stop. That's it. That's everything anyone ever needs to know about what horror does. That's it. Nothing else. And I was like, oh, that's it. That was a great moment. And also, I love this, where he likened his love of Texas Chainsaw Massacre. He likens it to being Texas Chainsaw Massacre to being real sex, and Friday 13th is masturbation. And then he takes a beat. He goes, or a hand job. Because, but basically, it's a bunch of bullshit. And I thought that was pretty glorious. He just thinks it's too cynical. It's a cash grab. And the most interesting thing about it, and this wasn't giving away, this should, I hope this hooks you to want to listen to it, is they have this one really interesting moment where I know I said to Rob, like, the jump cut felt like, something that people love, but that failed. You understand that sting of what the thing is. Well, Bret Easton Ellis likens the kind of success and failure that was American Psycho, because American Psycho literally got him fired from his label, and it basically was a complete disaster for him in that moment as an artist. But now if you look at it, it's, you know, one of the most cult popular books of all time, and John Carpenter's a huge fan of it.
Yeah.
And he was like, and at one point Brett goes, because The Thing, you know, we're similar. And Carpenter goes, oh, I know. I was going to ask you about that, because like about how similar that failure is, and that something is loved 20 years later does not take away the sting and the pain, because it got you fired or lost you jobs because people were too politically correct for the most. Usually it's a thing in the landscape. So E.T. had just come out in The Thing's case, but in Brady Stanellis, it was like a time where like culture warriors, kind of like now, are hitting the airwaves in this and internet in our case. But just interesting. I really recommend it. It's a really short listen. I wish there was more to it, but
yeah, that Thing quote. It's funny because Guillermo del Toro got on Twitter earlier this week and just went on a whole rants about how great Carpenter was. I mean, it's really great to hear.
Oh, cool.
People have picked up some articles.
Yeah, somebody retweeted us in that this morning.
Yeah, he goes on and on, kind of going almost film by film and explaining why he thinks it's a masterpiece and how we need to appreciate John now. And then he tells one anecdote that he had dinner with John and said, you know, do you understand The Thing is like a modern masterpiece and a work of art, and everybody loves it and it inspired me and this and that. And John's reply was like, what good does that do me now?
He's like, well, and I think it's part of John's charm is he's not nostalgic. He just made the work and then moved to the next work. And I think a lot of great filmmakers did that.
Yeah.
But it's hard for us to believe that because we want them to gush over something that's in the past. You know?
Right, right.
I one thing I've never heard John say, have you ever heard him say what during the process was his favorite work, like the favorite film, like as he was working on it? I don't think I've ever heard that.
No,
I know
really.
Big Trouble was a good experience.
We should ask him that someday.
Yeah. I hope so. That's the goal. That's the dream.
Yeah.
Definitely the dream guest.
All right. So what have you guys seen? I've seen a couple things, but why don't you shoot us off, Elric?
Yeah.
One of the ones I checked out, something I've been meaning to see for years, a movie I talked about at length last year, probably my favorite rediscovery of last year, was called The Reflecting Skin. Mm. Very art house David Lynch horror film. Very brutal.
That was a rough one for me.
Oh, really?
To
oh, man.
No, I mean, like, it was, I look back and I'm like, that was a beautiful film, but I struggled to keep going with that just because the imagery is so intense and everything is so miserable and bleak. There's not a single high point in that movie.
Well, there's high points. Like, there's an exploding frog. There's, you know, a guy lights himself
on
fire.
Father drinks gasoline and lights himself on fire.
Yeah, there's weird child pedophile vampires. It's a very Lynchian.
Bleak.
It's a Lynchian film. I think it's really a master. Like, of the last decade of movies I can think of off the top of my head, that getting that on Blu-ray will be the one I want most. I know there's a UK right now. So check that out. This is the follow-up film the guy made. He got a lot of... that film was shot in Canada, but he's a British artist called Philip Ridley.
Is that Canada?
Yeah, it
looks
Alberta.
Like the Midwest.
Yeah, that was the idea. Yeah. But it was all shot in Alberta. And the last issue of Rue Morgue was completely dedicated to it. And it was on the front cover, which was really cool to see. Anyway, it's just a masterpiece. His follow-up was a movie I'd always seen the cover. It's Brendan Fraser, Ashley Judd, and Viggo Mortensen. It's like a weird love triangle thing set in the middle of nowhere in a forest. Brendan Fraser is really strange. I think this is really early Brendan Fraser. He basically plays a Neanderthal man who's like, he's unfrozen. And Pauly Shore comes in. And
this is Encino Man, right?
Oh, same thing. This is the art house. Yeah, okay.
Encino Man.
Oh, buddy. Okay, anyway. No,
he had me going there.
Yeah, that's good. He basically just opens with this guy's like broken away from a kind of cult his family's in. They're all very innocent-minded. And you don't really, it's kind of mysterious. It's so trying to hit those Lynch tropes, and it just everything that works for me in Reflecting Skin is kind of tried again here but doesn't quite work.
And what's it called?
It's called The Passion of Darkly Noon, because the character's name is Darkly, and the passion is literally like the Christ passion. He ends up, because he's basically he starts having a thing for Ashley Judd but can't act on it because of his religion, and he starts kind of like hurting himself, and then she's married to Vigo doesn't speak because he's basically reduced to being a mime, and you're just like, what the hell? And it keeps building and building. It's an interesting movie, but it ends with a real burst of violence, so kind of nothing much happens. It's implications that she's a witch. Kind of builds. It's art house horror, slight horror, and at the end has this. If anyone saw Let Us Pray last year,
which is awesome,
which I really liked. It's basically, I think Let Us Pray definitely took the ending of this film, where there's a cop character covered in barbed wire and he got blood all over him. It's exactly the same image of what Brendan Fraser
does
in his film.
Well, that's like a religious imagery. It's the barbed wire being the thorn.
Exactly what The Passion is referring to. But I would think it came from this film. It's a two UK-made films. I can't believe it wouldn't be. Mm-hmm. So it didn't quite work for me. I thought it was pretty interesting. But I would probably pass on that and just go straight to Reflecting Skin if you had to make that choice. Mm. But interesting movie.
You know, at trivia this past week, I did, for those who don't know, we host a horror trivia night in Los Angeles, Dead Right Horror Trivia. And this past week, I did an art house horror round just for you, Elric, and you weren't there. I
needed a
pulled
babysitter.
All of these stills from these art movies.
I got texts from my team going, oh, we needed you for this one.
Yeah, it was kind of, because I included a picture from the Reflecting Skin. And seriously, like, I think the winning team out of the 10 stills, the winning team maybe got 5 of them. You would have gotten every single one.
Damn, I missed out. But that was a great movie. And also, I'll do a couple now before we move.
Sure.
One you borrowed, lent me, sorry, by Stuart Gordon, later period film, King of the Ants.
Yeah.
And you know what? Really, what was cool about seeing it, this is not a backhanded compliment. This is actually a compliment about this film. It's kind of remarkable. It feels like somebody's first feature. Mm. And to be like that deep in your career and to make a film, the guy who did Before the Devil Knows You're Dead, Sidney Lumet, one of his last films, had that same feeling. You were like, this feels like a young man's movie, and he was at the end of his long, long career. This has a feel. It's very gritty. It's very dark. It's twisted. The camera feels loose and kind of it just keeps following characters. It didn't feel, at all static. And so I thought that was really cool. It's really ugly. It's brutal. It's more of a crime picture that has a kind of ugly end. George Wendt and Daniel Baldwin. It's an interesting movie.
Definitely not horror per se.
I mean, it kind of strays into that.
Yeah.
But what I
Carrie Wooler.
Yeah. She's really good. And when I got here, I just said to Rob, I think there's an interesting article to be written that I've yet to read, if it's out there, about latter period Gordon, because the three films I'm thinking between this, Edmund, and Stuck, we're talking about, they're all moving away from horror to like dark crime. They still have horror overtones, but they're not fantastical anymore.
Right.
So it's a complete remove from his Lovecraft post-Dagon work, but they have, there's something in there. I kind of want to rewatch all three, and maybe I'll do that.
Yeah. Those are last three movies,
yeah,
right?
Last Stuck,
so it's kind of like
one, yeah.
Cronenberg doing his like History of Violence, Eastern Promises era.
Where did his Master of Horror pieces fit in there? Because those are definitely like more traditionally old.
Yeah.
No, both, because Dreams of a Witch House is Lovecraft.
Right.
And then the Poe one definitely has classic horror.
I mean, the Poe one I think is brilliant. I think that's actually one of the great shorter form films.
He might have done those before Stuck.
He might. I still feel like Stuck was the last picture.
Yeah.
Anyway, I just think that's really interesting. And if you're watch those three together, I think if you're looking at revisiting some of these, Edmund's really interesting because it's a mammoth play, but done in a really like almost like Inferno with like really interesting lighting. And William H. Macy is having like this little descent to hell. It didn't quite work for me when I first saw it, but I really want to revisit it. I'm glad you lent that one to me though, because I think now I've seen all his films. I think that was the one film I've never
seen Edmund. I need to check
out.
I have that one too, and I haven't had a chance to watch it, but I'm going to after what you just said.
A little more theatrical, but Macy's really good.
Yeah.
And it makes you wish they had done the Reanimator.
Oh, with him as
the president.
That would be
amazing. It would have been great.
That would have been epic.
I've got a couple others, but let's dance around.
Yeah, ahead, so Becca. I watched Eyes of a Stranger, which was recommended by Elric. And I got to tell you, when it arrived, I was like, seriously, what is this? Because the cover that they put with it, it looks like the lowest B-level horror you could possibly watch. Because it's like a modern art interpretation of like a woman's feet dangling. Uh-huh. And it's just this awful painting. And I was like, oh, what is this? And, it was not a perfect film for me. I definitely had some complaints with it, but it was really cool, some of the things that it did.
It was very atmospheric.
Yeah, it was very atmospheric. You know who the killer is from the get-go.
Yeah, it's not a whodunit.
Yeah, and so that was kind of one of the weird things for me, is I spent the whole movie going, oh, they have to be like pulling your leg, and then they're going to be like, oh, it's not this guy, it's this guy. But no, you know who the killer is, like right from frame one. One thing that did shock me was how absolutely kind of sadistic and brutal the killer was. Like, it went far more than I was expecting it to. Like, just him slapping people for a long time and things like that. Like,
it's also
it really
the performance.
It held.
I think it's one of the best bad guy performance where it just feels completely real.
Completely.
Like, it's like, who is this guy? I've never seen him before
and
on screen.
How just absolutely repulsive he is to begin with. How he just has this kind of sinister feel. Because, I mean, in a lot of films, when they have serial killers, they're still, I'll call it Hollywood pretty. Like Anthony Hopkins, you look at, and you're like, yeah, he's creepy looking, but he's not hideous. This guy was just downright hideous from the start.
Yeah, he's kind of gross.
Just really repulsive from the beginning.
And you've got a blind Jennifer Jason Leigh.
Yeah, which when she first came on, I was like, is that Jennifer Jason Leigh? And then she took her top off, and I was like, oh, my God. Yeah,
I don't remember her taking it. She's so young, though, isn't
she? Yeah, he does at the end. So she definitely, their top's off, and it's a little bizarre because she is so young.
This is important because it's directed by Ken Wiederhorn, who directed a film called Shockwaves, The Deep End in Horror.
It is not.
Work that in every episode.
The Eyes of a Stranger, it's not a fast-moving film, so it's not kind of,
I don't think any of his films
are.
No, not at all, especially Shockwaves.
Yeah, and a lot of it is filmed, Dave kept calling it the Sybil Shepherd lens, where it's this kind of like dreamy, it looks like they smeared Vaseline all over the frame.
It felt to me like a really awesome TV movie when I saw it. I'd never heard of it. Jared Rivet.
Was it not a TV
movie? It could have been.
Did you get the DVD on its own, the DVD?
Yeah, it was released, it was like the Twisted Films collection.
No, yeah, I was about to mention
that. Awful cover.
No, this is a big deal. Warner Brothers, because as we've known, Warner Brothers catalog is kind of difficult, especially the horror ones to get.
Yeah, they haven't been able to get
Blu-ray. So they put out a collection called, it's called the Twisted Terror Collection. I just looked
that
up. That's
it,
The reason I like it is because it has Eyes of a Stranger, it has Deadly Friend, Wes Craven, Dr. Giggles, The Hand, which is, I think,
Michael Caine's.
Michael Caine's The Hand, which is Oliver Stone, right? One of his early movies.
Yeah.
First one.
From Beyond the Grave and Someone's Watching Me, which John Carpenter wrote.
The Tom Berenger one, is it?
No, what's her name is in it? Is it Laura Hutton?
I know what you're talking about. Yes, I think it is because it's on the double pack with that.
Yeah.
For most part.
But so there was this collection that came out. I was under the impression it's been long out of print for many, many years, and then it's expensive to get them separately. I just looked up on Amazon. You can get this collection for $16.99 right now.
Yeah, Eyes of the Stranger. I didn't buy the whole collection. I just bought the disc, but I swear it was like pennies.
And this is a good. I still love this collection to this day because it's like the weirdest movies from the these directors.
They don't look well. At least Eyes of the Stranger did not look pretty. It was better than nothing, but it was definitely, and I mean that combined with what I can only assume was a directorial choice, the kind of smeared dreamy,
the Vaseline.
Yeah, the very dreamy, foggy landscape that he gives the entire film, which I think was supposed to be kind of, visions, and it just gives it kind of a hazy look.
I think Jeff Nelson's a big fan of that film.
He asked me on Facebook what I thought of it. So yeah, definitely if you're a horror fan, and especially if you're a slasher, or it definitely has a lot of giallo notes, even though that you know who the killer is from the beginning, it still has that same kind of build to
it.
I'd recommend checking it out.
Sense,
it was a good little gem. I'm glad I found. The other thing that I did this week is Derek put up on our site this fantastic article on how we need more kid horror. And the article's great because it goes through, how we all had these kind of gateway horror films that we watched when we were kids, things like Monster Squad, that kind of ushered us in, and they were safe and they were fun when we were adolescents. And then by the time that we were old enough to, we were kind of primed for it, for much more extreme horror.
I haven't met a single horror fan who fits your description just then. Everyone I know had no gateway horror. Everyone I know got burned on Creepshow or Nightmare on Elm Street and then
got
worked
burned.
Their way back to the nice kid-friendly stuff. But
no,
carry on.
I definitely had gateway horror. And so,
yeah, but I mean, there were things that we watched over and over again as a kid because they were kind of more on the friendly tip.
Even if it was Scooby-Doo.
Scooby-Doo.
Ghostbusters.
Ghostbusters, The Gate, Monster Squad. Like, these are things you just watched over
Ghoulies,
and over again.
There was definitely things that were far more accessible for me as a kid than, say, something like Eyes of a Stranger.
Sure.
Kind of gateway horror. And he talks about like The Witches, which was a big one for me when I was a kid, and just, kind
Nicholas
of
Nicholas Rogue directed, surprisingly.
It's a scary fucking
film. It's a weird movie.
So because he talked about it, I went back and watched Watcher in the Woods. Which is Disney. So fucked up. It's about this girl whose friends, and this is like back long ago in the 50s, her friends are doing this weird seance game, and she gets trapped in another dimension, and her mom's Betty Davis, but not like pretty Betty Davis, like scary
Towards
Betty Davis.
End, yeah.
And she gets trapped in this other dimension, and now two girls move into her house, and she's trying to communicate with them through mirrors and glass and whispering, and they have to like redo this incantation seance game to try to bring her back into this world. It's most scary film ever. And then I also watched Return to Oz, which is the sequel to Wizard of Oz, which is just the most batshit crazy thing in the world, where it's
Fariza Balk.
Yeah, Fariza Balk.
Really, that's an awesome movie. Walter Murch made it.
Yeah, the Wheelers, which are these like guys in masks on wheels, like all four on wheels. Mombi, who's this witch who steals heads. I mean, there's just so much in that movie that I can't even come to terms with, that when I was a kid I thought was great. But so I revisited some of these, and then I ended up doing a round at trivia called When Disney Was Scary. But it was just amazing to rewatch some of these and think about how, you know, that these were kind of my gateway into horror,
well,
and
Snow
that
White,
these were the ones.
Mm-hmm. Snow White and Wizard of Oz are two of the original ones that would have scared the crap out of me. I saw the original Snow White recently, and it's gorgeous and scary. The witch is scary. I mean, if you're a kid.
But this weekend, actually, at CineFamily, they are showing two of the films that were kind of like my childhood treasures that I absolutely loved. They are showing Teen Witch, followed by The Worst Witch. I really wish BJ was in town to come with me for these. BJ, I never say your last
Colangelo.
Name. Colangelo. Thank you.
Listener to the show, occasional contributor to our site.
Yeah.
Well, next week
I wish she was coming with me, but instead, since BJ can't be along, I'm taking Rob.
Yeah, I got to go.
He is going to Teen Witch.
You know what?
We'll see if he survives,
Robin Lively was one of my crushes, so I'll handle.
It's,
I can handle
Teen
Witch.
It's a musical. It's kind of amazing.
Only one musical number, though, right?
Two.
Oh, all right.
There's one called I Like Boys, and then there's a rap number.
The rap I remember. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm dumb in
it.
Okay, cool. It's going to be awesome.
Let me shoot a few out. I know, Elric, you've still got some titles. But so, believe it or not, and hear me out here, as most people listening probably know by now, I'm a 3D junkie. I have a home 3D setup. And for a lot of movies that came out in the last couple years in 3D, I like to wait to watch it that way, because if it's the right filmmaker, they made it for that format, and I want it to be presented in the right way possible. So I've waited years to watch, don't laugh, Hansel and Gretel Witch Hunters.
You know,
3D.
It's actually a good movie. I'll say that loosely. It's got moments.
No, it's a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. And it's directed by Tommy Wirkola. Am I saying that right? Mm-hmm. Wirkola. He's the guy that directed the two Dead Snow movies. So if you know the weird kind of, I call it Peter Jackson-esque, like over-the-top violence but humor to it, of Dead Snow, and in particular Dead Snow 2, that's the one that's actually much better and has American actors. Witch Hunters is a movie that's in par with that, and like, I can't believe they gave him money to make it. It's like, because it's an R-rated, really gory retelling of the Hansel and Gretel legend, where they become witch hunters, and there's like terrifying imagery. It's like if Tim Burton made a rated R movie, like a really gory rated R movie. And the thing is, he's one of these directors that understands 3D. So the way it's used for this movie was actually a lot of fun and only added to it. I'm sure it's fine or kind of goofy if you just watch it regular, but seeing it in 3D the way it was intended to be, and, I mean, you've got Jeremy Renner and what's your name? Gemma
Arthurton.
The villain is Famke Janssen, who I'm convinced is a real witch because she's not aged in 20, 30 years.
No.
Since she started. She looks exactly the same as
she
always
played,
does.
She played a couple of decades ago on Star Trek. She played the most ideal woman in the world, like that every man would like want to be with. And she was supposed to be this most ideal human figure. And she still looks exactly the same.
Yeah, she's remained that way for 25 years somehow. So,
but that was one
deal
of
the devil, witch, I don't know.
That was one of the only things that really annoyed me about that movie is you've got Famke Janssen, and she's such a good actress and can do amazing things, and then you digitize the fuck out of her.
No. It's I'm convinced they didn't have her for long because there's no way that when she's in witch form, it's her. And she's in witch form for a lot of the movie. Oh. So that was my theory. Is like, they must have gotten her for like 3 days or something, and then they just hired some other actress to kind of do the thing. And that's the thing I've said is digital effects are way more forgiving in 3D because that's kind of what they're intended for. Yeah. If you see it in a flat surface, it's whatever. But I thought it was actually a lot of fun. Like, to get an R-rated version of a children's fantasy with big stars, like Hollywood stars, it's like I can't fathom how this movie happened. And produced by, or exec produced by, Will Ferrell and Adam McKay. They're in the credits, so they're the reason that movie got made, which makes me give it even more respect because those guys backed this crazy the Dead Snow director.
And if you don't have a lovely little 3D setup like Rob does, the movie is currently streaming on Netflix Instant, so you can always check it out there. But 3D is far better.
And then you'll
yell
at me because you're like, it wasn't that good, man. Well, whatever. You didn't see it in 3D. Screw you.
I'll wait for 3D at your house.
Yeah. What else? Oh, let me do this one really quick. Cat People, the Paul Schrader one. I'd never seen it before, but I took advantage of the Scream Factory. There was a sale on Amazon last week. I think it's still going on as of this recording. And, you know, I've been pretty good at keeping on top of the Scream Factory titles, but like always, there's a few titles that slip and that you forgot. Like, oh, man. So I'd never gotten Cat People. I picked it up. Never seen this movie. I was actually really mesmerized by the whole thing. It's a fascinating.
Sasha Kinski is like gorgeous.
She's and this isn't me just being typical like pervy guy or whatever. Like, I think her in that movie, not necessarily the performance, but her appearance is just one of the most remarkable like characters in horror. Like capturing her at that age, at that moment in that movie. I thought she's like one of the sexiest people ever captured.
Oh,
on
she
film.
Is. Yeah. It's
unbelievable.
Yeah.
And that movie, that's what makes that movie is just her mm-hmm. appearance. There's a lot of good other people in it, like secondary actors. And I'm not
McDowell.
Familiar. Yeah. I mean, McDowell is kind of
creepy and
weird.
He's creepy.
And the whole incestuous vibe, which is what kind of drives the weird sexuality of the piece.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
I remember the soundtrack being awesome.
Soundtrack's great. There's that David Bowie song. Mm-hmm. A lot of people, I remember when it came out, complained that it was too digitized, that they over-cleaned it up. It looked fine on my setup, but you know what? It looked more like, it looked kind of like a DVD, meaning that it didn't look as crisp and clean as the average cleaned up digital restoration should. Now, a lot of times, I mean, now Scream Factory kind of goes out of their way to do their own transfers. A lot of times, like Nick Redman from Twilight Time explained to us on Killer POV, sometimes when you make a deal with a studio, you have to get whatever their HD transfer is that they have in their vault. Like, it'd be too expensive to make one again. So I'm guessing that's what it was, is they just took whatever the studio offered them, and that's the version they put out, which by means doesn't look bad at all. It's just I didn't think it was as bad as, you know, when people attacked it when that release came out. But really, really fascinating and sexy movie. I really liked it.
Speaking of sexy,
hey now,
Scream Factory's release of Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2.
That is sexy. Yeah, that's
I watched
sexy.
That. I gotta say, I watched this with Senor De Grunert. This is a fun movie. Yeah. I had not seen it in about 10 years. He hadn't seen it in like 20.
Wow.
So this was the way to revisit it. And all the things that were problematic when I was young with it are still problematic, but I didn't care now, so I just enjoyed the shit out of it. It is, I mean, for one, in the history of cinema, there's never been a stranger follow-up by the same director to a film.
Oh,
I
yeah.
mean, these two films are basically polar opposites. This is the flat, outright comedy, basically.
Well, it's not like a sequel.
Pastel. I mean, well, yeah, but it is.
It is.
It's got
it's
all
a
the same characters.
It's the same characters, but it kind of like resets the universe.
I guess. Well, it resets the style of the universe, but the story is still happening 17 years later, I believe it was. It was a long time. So
it was 22.
Yeah, it took obviously a long time.
Something, yeah.
I don't have a lot to say about it besides buy it. I mean, I actually couldn't talk nonstop about it, but what I will say, the one thing I turned at one point to Dick and I went, Rob Zombie's entire cinematic universe can be distilled in this one movie.
Mm-hmm.
Literally, there's whole sequences where I'm like, oh, that's that entire thing from House of the Dead.
That was my biggest problem with House of a Thousand Corpses when it initially came out. As I'm watching, I'm like, this is very Chainsaw 2.
Bill Moseley. But then, I mean, literally, I mean, you could say Devil's Rejects feels like a direct, same world. I can imagine a character walking from one scene. It's like, obviously, Devil's Rejects darker, more a little more real.
Yeah.
But it's the look and feel. You know, Bill Moseley, his love of Moseley, obviously, goes to town. Moseley's great in this. Like, I think I'd forgotten just how funny and weird his character is in this.
You guys should also see The Sadist, because that's the one that I think is definitely like Rob Zombie distilled into.
I can see it. This is more. I'm telling you, like, this movie, watch it again. It is every color. I mean, he's lifting whole chunks. I mean, he's just stealing the thing where they take the mask, the face, and puts it on the girl
and
dances. And it's just like, there were about three scenes neither of us remembered being in. We're like, oh, weird. But it's so fun, especially if you're somebody who thinks the first Chainsaw is great. This is really fun to watch because you're like, oh, weird. And also, Dennis Hopper, I say it all the time, but worst hero in the history of cinema. Watch it with this in mind. Every time he has a chance to save or help someone, watch what happens. Not once does it work. He is like the worst hero you've ever seen.
He doesn't care. He's hell-bent on revenge.
He's so cool. Yeah. I love it. So anyway, that one's well worth your time. The big one that I saw, which was really interesting. Sam Zimmerman, who is one of the guys who picks the films for Shudder and used to write for Fango with you and Shuck to Your Drop, he had come on our show a while back, our old show, and said that the movie release I would be most into was a film called Symptoms. And I'd never even heard of this film. Dick got it for me for my birthday, and it just came. It's Mondo Macabro, and he also got one called Medusa, which I'm going to check out soon. It looked really cool, too. A Greek horror film. Anyway, this one... It ticks all my sweet spots. It's a slow, you'll hate it. It's a slow burn, and I mean slow. The pacing's really, but it's never boring. You always are waiting for what's going to happen. It's Donald Pleasance's daughter. It's Whoa. An old UK, very underseen UK film that's been restored. There's a movie this year that is probably the closest thing I can compare it to. It was called Duke of Burgundy, which was very well reviewed, one of the best reviewed movies of the year. Not really horror. This one is a horror film. It has the same kind of setup, two girls in a nice kind of mansion in the middle of nowhere. Something bad has happened, psychodrama, maybe trauma-related, and then little bits of gothic ghost story. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to give away too much. I think it's really well worth people watching this film. I think they're going to really like it. It's super kind of simple, but you're always, there's something bad at the heart of it that I think people will dig. And it's by a guy called Jose Miran Larraz, and he's a Spanish director, not even from the UK. And the extra features are worth it alone, because he's probably like 80 years old now, and that comes on, he's like, every reason I stay interested in movies, people like him and Jodorowsky, he's just like, yeah, I like movies, I like the blood and the breasts and the girls. And, and you're just like, instantly grabs your attention, because he's just so excited and full of life for cinema. And so I think this is going to be a fun release. I think this will definitely be, if you're into the art house side of horror, this will be a definite pickup for you. Mm-hmm. Everyone else might be a little slower. There isn't as much payoff. And the last thing I'm just going to throw out there, because it's streaming, I think this is something people should watch if you're into this kind of thing. It's called Entertainment. It's by Rick Alverson. It is a indie comedy in quote marks. This is, to me, a descent to hell itself. It is a horror film. If you know, my favorite comedian besides Louis C.K. and things like that, for a long time has been this guy called Neil Hamburger.
Yeah.
Because he's not funny, and his shtick is so fucking weird, but I didn't really realize who he was in real life. Like, I didn't know. I just assumed he had to be like this guy. It's just, retweets about Taco Bell all the time, making people sick. He has this shtick. Well, this guy decided to make a film about that guy on the road going across America, shot gorgeously. It's all shot widescreen and, like, looks like a fucking art house epic, but of just this guy going from gig to gig, and it's sad and it's depressing, and you're just like, God, what? So basically, it's The Wrestler meets King of Comedy by Scorsese by way of The Road, Cormac McCarthy's Dark fucking Road. It is those three films in a blender.
I will never make it through this movie.
You wouldn't. Dave will love it. Your husband will love
it. Dave will love it.
But the actor who plays Neil Hamburger is Greg Turkington, and what was so cool, if you're aware of his character, Neil, is he's really Greg. He's himself for 90% of the movie, and then he does the character a couple of, and you see this very sad kind of, sad. It's a depressing movie, but I actually think it is a horror film, and I don't just mean so I could talk about it on the show. It has musical cues that are like horror cues, and you're like, what in this like comedy?
Wow.
It is really hard to explain, but ever since I posted kind of on Twitter, I was like, oh, I just saw this film. What a performance. Everyone's been writing going, yeah, he's like does a show all the time in LA, and he does things with Tim and Eric, and that's who I think who wrote this.
Oh my
Those
God.
Comedian guys this wrote
is,
this.
This movie was like made for Dave. That's like his favorite comedy duo, and I'm so annoyed by them.
I honestly wouldn't have even talked, and it was random that I even watched it, but I wouldn't normally talk about it on the show, but I think for certain people, even just watch the first 10 minutes, because that's kind of the tone of the whole movie. I really think it is like a weird, dark character. It's like a 70s movie, like dark character portrayal. But and if you haven't checked out Neil Hamburger, YouTube it first, and you'll see it is the most off-color, weird comedy you'll ever see in your life. But yeah, so and it's a lot of stuff to get through, but entertainment's interesting.
Wow. Well, to wrap up, I have two more films. They go together, and I wrote about them on the website this week. So I've been fascinated by the late 90s cycle of horror, because when some of those movies are coming out post-Scream, they didn't feel really like original or fun. It's like, all right, everything's not knocking Scream up. But now, looking back, they all have this weird aesthetic, this weird 90s horror aesthetic. So I did a double bill of I Know What You Did Last Summer, and I Still Know What You Did Last Summer.
Oh, the double, whoa.
I'd say I Know What You Did Last Summer is probably the biggest movie next to Scream of that era. Like, those were the two big ones, both written by Kevin Williamson. I haven't seen either of them in... at least a decade. It's been at least 10 years. I have my friend Kat Knipover, who co-hosts the Boys and Ghouls podcast. So she's going to be talking about this. I think she went and got the original book, too. So she got hardcore about researching.
Oh my God, there's a book?
It's based on like a young
teen,
adult novel.
Yeah, that makes
oh,
sense.
Like a teen novel called I Know What You Did Last Summer. So we watched it together, and I'm glad we did because she's a little bit younger than me, and she like memorized like everything about that first movie. So it was like really funny to see somebody who would be able to quote Ryan Phillippe perfectly.
Wow.
And tell me Buffy history because of Sarah Michelle Gellar.
Yeah.
And note things like
and her husband, Freddie Prinze.
Freddie Prinze, yeah. You know what's funny? So this movie was...
Oh my gosh. Sorry, the book is by Lois Duncan. This woman like ruled my childhood. She was like, it was like... Total like R.L.
Is this like
Stein
in her
type stuff?
Oh, so it's a type of stuff. Okay,
yeah.
So it's
she was R.L. Stein before R.L. Stein came along because there was R.L. Stein. Goosebumps was definitely a little bit late for me. Mm. But when I was like really young in middle school, it was like Christopher Pike and Lewis Duncan were like the two horror writers that were like really cool when I was in elementary school.
Right.
So yeah. Oh my gosh, I have
I'm
no
sure
idea
that it's
her.
Based on material.
I know. I'm
the
sure
plot
it doesn't.
Is so paper thin.
I probably sure. read this book when I was in like fourth grade.
I'm sure it doesn't have the graphic murders. In it
or cleavage. Or best thing about the movie.
Yeah. What are you waiting for?
Oh my
anyway.
God.
Sorry about that.
I'm still waiting, Jennifer.
It's okay. I actually, you know what? It's not bad. I had a lot of fun with it, actually, because it really did hit all those beats that kind of scream. It's like a Scream knockoff, but it's still kind of good enough that I was thoroughly entertained by it. And it's funny because I'd say maybe the first 5 or 10 minutes you're meeting these characters and it's. You're reminded of me, like, oh yeah, this is the guy that created Dawson's Creek. In fact, they call something Dawson, like it's yeah. it's in the dialogue. Like they don't feel like kids. It's the moment, you know, as the plot is, they hit a guy with their car and decide to just toss him in the river and like never talk about it again. From the moment that happens, and they're all turned up to 10, where they're all screaming at each other, like you're not going to tell anybody. I thought it got really good. I was yeah. like, oh, they can act. They're all right, yeah. you know? The first 5 minutes they're trying to be kids, not so good. But then once that happens, and then a year passes, and then somebody's sending them notes saying, I know what you did last summer. And from there, it becomes kind of this murder mystery thing like, you know, who is it? Is it somebody that knew the guy they accidentally killed? Or what's the story behind it? But yeah, it was a lot of fun.
And it becomes Deadliest Catch.
much,
which is probably yeah. the closest comparison. But I actually remember really enjoying the first one in theaters, and then I remember going to the second one and being really disappointed.
Yeah.
So I
had not
Danny
seen,
Cannon directed that one.
Yeah, I had not. The first one was directed by Jim Gillespie. Who ended up doing that movie Venom in about 2005, kind of part of that cycle. He also did that what ended up being the directed video Sylvester Stallone movie, I See You, spelled I-Y-E.
Oh,
that was,
yeah,
oh.
yeah.
Yeah, so he did some interesting choices post this movie. But it's funny because his short film Joyride is on the Blu-ray that got him the job to do I Know What You Did Last Summer. And I always love watching that because you get to see there's so much about in that short that's like, oh, I see why they picked him to make this movie. The second one came out exactly a year later. It's still as awful as I remember.
Yeah.
I mean, it feels like they, rather than take the time to, it feels like ideas that they threw out there and then just like wrote a movie around it. Like, well, we got to get us all to the Bahamas. So then it's like she wins a radio contest where the radio
with the wrong info.
That's the thing. The radio calls wow. them, by the way. They don't call in. Like the phone rings and it's like, hey, this is the radio. What's the capital of Brazil? And they're like, Rio. And they're like, great, you won the trip. Now, I'm sure 99.9% of the audience probably didn't know that was not true because that shows our geographical
wow.
knowledge. But yeah, it all banks on the fact that they're idiots that didn't get this question wrong. They all end up in the Bahamas. Her best friend all of a sudden is Brandy, who's terribly annoying, but you know, whatever. And it has a twist that's so – you kind of see it coming, but it's so bad that I literally slapped my forehead when it happened because I'm like,
awesome.
What? The things that stand out about it. At the time, I absolutely hated this white guy pretending to be Jamaican because it was the most he was like the most awful human being on the planet. Well, it's Jack Black. and now when you watch it, you're like, oh, Jack Black is actually succeeding at being an annoying guy
right.
and hence is the best actor in this movie. And the other surprise, which I completely forgot about.
Can I guess?
The guy that takes care of the hotel
get a job in the sideshow.
Jeffrey Combs.
I did get that when I was in theaters back when I was young. Completely and that was the only good thing about it.
And he's a wonderful highlight to the movie. He's not in it that long, but he pops up and you're like, so oh, it's Jeffrey Combs.
Because that
amazing.
Guy made a real movie, The Young Americans with Harvey Keitel before, like a big crime film. Mm. So I totally see why he got a gig, but then you're watching it, this is so flat. I wish they had gone darker. Like Friday the 13th got more sexy, more grisly. Instead, it just kind of stayed in that very CWPC
thing. Yeah, of all the things they could have done for a sequel, and that's why I feel like it must have been rushed. Because the other thing is, it has the audacity to be like an hour and 40 minutes long.
Yeah.
And you feel it. Yeah. You're like, oh my God. So
like
I feel like they were just like, let's just start shooting and get this movie out there. Because I remember a really great teaser trailer that is not in the movie at all of her like in therapy and she goes up to a mirror and says it's all over and then the fisherman comes bursting through the mirror and it's just for the teaser. Mm-hmm. And then because they were just such in a rush to get this one out. And it killed the franchise right there. I mean, they made a third one, but who cares?
They did? What was that one?
I'll always know what you did
and
last
was
summer.
Was she in it again?
No, it's not. It's all new kids. It's almost essentially a remake of the first one with everybody's recast. The only interesting thing is that the fisherman in it is played by Don Shanks, who played Michael Myers in Halloween 5.
Yeah, random.
And I remember asking him about it when he was on the convention circuit when he was making it.
Yeah.
And I'm like, so tell me about the movie. He's like, oh, who cares what you did last summer? like even he was like,
but
whatever.
But it's a fisherman again?
It's the fisherman
again.
Wow,
I'd want him to mix it up if they were kind of like all new kids, same plot. Let's at least like make him something different.
Yeah. I don't even remember if it's the same fisherman. I
don't
know.
It probably isn't.
Is it in any way connected?
No, it was a direct-to-video movie. Same with the third, like Urban Legends, which was a direct-to-video thing. But whatever. First one's fun. Second one, no. But that's that. So that's the pre-show. We're going to check in with Ryan Turek, who's got a pick of the week. And then he's going to join us for our interview today.
We've got three guests to rule them all.
Yes.
That's your clue.
That's your clue. Stand by. Hello and welcome to this special segment of Shockwaves. I'm sitting here with the director of development, Ryan Turek, and he is here to give us his pick of the week.
Pick of the week.
Back
pick
again.
Of the week. Yes.
People can't get enough Turek on our show.
Can't get enough of the stuff.
The stuff,
which
that's
is
your
my
pick.
Which is my pick. Nice segue. You like teed it up and just hit it across the finish line. No, the stuff. Arrow Video just put out this great Blu-ray.
They did. I picked it up.
Yeah. It's and I'm sure you guys have talked about it, but I rewatched it and that movie is some zany shit.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not scary. Mm-hmm. It's like a lot of Cohen stuff. It's super subversive, and it's got a lot going on beneath the surface.
Did he write and direct that one?
Yeah.
I think so, yeah.
I think so, yeah. Yeah. And it's just a really interesting movie, not just about that kind of skewers big corporations, but also, kind of dietary habits of human beings, I watch this stuff and I'm like, what's the stuff in 2016? What is the thing? And you can like throw a rock and hit any kind of dietary fad from like the gluten stuff which I'm probably going to get yelled at for this because my dad is on the gluten thing and, organics, you go to the grocery store and you're like, oh, here's some organic cucumbers. Oh, here's some normal cucumbers. I'm going to go with the cheaper normal ones. no, but it's just it's an interesting film. Lots of like cameos and some great effects and the effects are so great. I forgot about the dog gag, where Danielle is like getting attacked by the dog.
Oh,
that's Danielle, right?
Yeah, I think
Yeah. But Arrow's Blu-ray looks amazing, and some great special features on that. But if you haven't seen the stuff, I exposed a couple of people who had never seen it to the stuff, and they loved it. They thought it was fantastic. They were just like kind of blown away by the tonal shifts that happen. And Michael Moriarty, someone was like, I hate that guy's voice. I'm like, well, it's Michael Moriarty. Yeah, he's just a weird dude.
He's a one of a kind.
He takes like such weird creative liberties with things sometimes. There's that one bit where he gets on the boat and he's meeting the ice cream conglomerates.
Right.
The ice cream conglomerates. And he's like, oh, we got a sweaty palm here. Oh, another sweaty palm. Oh, sweaty palms. Hello, Mr. Sweaty Palm. And you're like, what the hell? That's like such a weird choice. The stuff. Wow. That's my choice.
And how do you feel about it in terms of Larry Cohen's filmography?
Oh, I think it's archetypal Larry Cohen.
Yeah.
Like, I think between I think it's like God told me to. I mean, they're all like on a different spectrum, you know. But in terms of like what Larry Cohen's known for, which is taking kind of like every day and throwing some sort of really crazy message into it, you know, it's like God told me to the stuff. What would It's Alive probably be another part of that trilogy, I think.
Yeah.
Because It's Alive has a lot to say as well, you know, not just about, you know, kind of, what do you call it? I don't know what you call a whole pregnancy, like, world. But, you know, just in terms of talking about taking – how the world affects women and how it affects pregnancy and how it affects our children and all that kind of stuff. You know, it has a lot to say. I think it's cool.
Can we remake this stuff? Is there a remake in that story? with gluten and organic food?
Organic food? It would have to be – I don't know if people would buy – food moving on its own. It'd have to be like, it would have to affect people in a different way. Like, it can't be like opening the fridge and a kid opening the fridge at midnight and seeing the stuff crawling back into its container, which is great. By the way, if you guys want to see a kid flip out in a grocery store in a big way, watch the stuff. Yeah. That kid goes to town. It's so funny. Wow. So funny. But yeah, you would have to make that. You would have to make the stuff, but it would have to, the impact of it would have to be a little bit more grounded, I think. You would have to, like, see people reacting in a way that's a little bit different. Maybe even psychologically. Who knows?
All right.
Yeah.
You never know. Well, there you go. Ryan's pick of the week is The Stuff.
Yeah.
Hang tight. He's actually sitting in on the next interview with you, so should be fun. Okay, and welcome back to the show. We're very excited to have two-thirds of SpectreVision. We'll have all three, hopefully, in a little bit. But joining us right now is Daniel Noah and Elijah Wood. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for coming in.
Any room that has the Terra poster behind them is kind of a cool setup for any horror podcast.
Wow. That's such a dope-looking Terra poster, too.
Those are the
two.
You
guys have a great collection of posters.
Great posters. Right?
Yeah. Yeah. I think they were both gifted to Jason. I think that was the thing. And those are the two largest posters.
The Italian Exorcist.
Yeah, that Exorcist is a beautiful one.
Yeah. So I like your Prowler, too.
Yeah. It was funny. I had a director in once who skewed more towards comedy, but I had done like a kind of a horror comedy, and the greatest quote he said was, he's like, I love horror. He's like, I really love horror, but I'm not like the Prowler guy like you are. And I was like, you know what? I know exactly what you mean. I know exactly. It takes a very specific kind to be the Prowler guy.
Yeah. The Prowler, he likes the Creep Show, but not Prowler. But that's a commitment.
That's the divide.
What about you guys? Like, let's go back to origins of horror, like falling in love with it from childhood. Like, was that your path, like so many of us, or something different?
It was, yeah. I mean, I think I saw my first horror movie when I was 5 or 6. I had the benefit of having a brother that's 7 years older than me. So, you know, he would rent movies with his friends, bring them home. Unbeknownst to my mother, I was exposed to all these great movies. One of my first films or first memories is a movie called Truth or Dare or Critical Madness. Do you know that? Shot on video, direct to video.
I know the video cover.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so great.
I'm still working on the
video. It sounds like a re-release. Yeah, yeah.
It's so great. And I've seen it many times since. And then, Nightmare on Elm Street 3, I think, is a early one for me as well.
Which is good because it's got all the fantasy side of horror, too. Which is when a lot of us fall in love, I think.
It's still one of my favorite films, that movie.
Yeah.
It's great. So, yeah, I don't know. I was never really scared by horror movies. I kind of was always intrigued. And it's that thing when you're a kid, too. It's this forbidden fruit, things you're not supposed to see. You know, you feel like you're sort of in private and secret seeing these things that are sort of clandestine.
Right.
And that kind of ultimately evolves and as your taste sort of evolves and you sort of explore the genre, you know.
What about you, Noah?
I had a series of sort of like tentpole experiences that I've often looked back on to sort of analyze my own emotional architecture. But my grandfather, whom I was extremely close with, would always show me the Universal Monster movies. I remember watching them on this teeny little TV that they kept on their kitchen table. They were always on Saturdays. And they were, you know, the Universal Monsters were generally misunderstood misfits. They weren't, you know, with the exception of the Invisible Man, you know, they were all, you know, I related to them emotionally.
They're actually vulnerable.
They're very vulnerable. Yeah.
Invisible Man was just a dick.
Yeah.
He's just a straight up terrorist. I mean,
totally. Yeah. And interestingly, the hardest one to crack, I think. Yeah. Like, it's, My favorite is Memoirs of an Invisible Man, talking of Carpenter. Oh, yeah. I love that film so much.
I love that movie, too.
Yeah. You just convinced me to rewatch it, because that is a movie when I started, and I remember going, no thanks, when I was like,
well,
on
I think
video.
The problem was that they cast a comedian, and there was this expectation that it was going to be a Chevy Chase film, and it's not. It's a John Carpenter film. Chevy's actually quite good in
the
movie.
He is. And Sam Neill's the bad guy?
Yeah.
That's enough to rewarm.
I'm surprised you aren't in love with
him. I know. I'm wearing Sam Neill clothes. Oh, yeah. I'm always Sam Neill fan. Kiwi, I always have to go for that every time. Yeah, I think there's something special about who you watch the initial horror films. A lot of people, you end up alone watching them as you go. But like your dad was fully in, you know, Ryan, your dad was fully into. Like, I had a stepdad who was a minister in Wellington. He watched every Friday 13th movie. Those were the only ones he watched. And he would chuckle. He would like have this little high-pitched cackle. And I was like, you know, 11 years old or something. And he just was so into it. And he would go, oh, but you better not be watching this, Elric. And I just turned to him and go, why are you watching it? But I think it's special. Like, I don't know. There's some security that adds to watching these films.
My mom was a diehard sci-fi fan. She still is the truest word of Trekkie. And so I grew up with all these like horrific sci-fi films, and it just bridged into horror really quickly. Yeah.
Well, for me, I know I was kind of unsupervised because I had much older parents that weren't paying attention, and a video store at the corner with a guy with like a mohawk, total punk rocker, would just like. I mean, I was so young, and I just like stumble up there, and it'd be like "Spit on Your Grave," "Henry Porter, Serial Killer." Have fun, little dude. all right, cool.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, so I got to see a lot of fucked up shit way early. But
old were you when you were watching those films?
I think I started. Well, I started Universal Monsters when I was really young, and like you, it didn't really scare me. I related. I thought they were cool. I wanted to draw them. Mm-hmm. I thought visually they were super cool. I'd say probably around the 10 mark was when my cousins sat me down and forced me to watch Nightmare on Elm Street, the original, which just scarred me and kind of set me on this path inadvertently. Yeah. So that's what it was. But
I was going to say, the drawing, I remember distinctly drawing everything because it took away their power.
Right.
Yeah. It took away how scared I was because I didn't understand Freddy Krueger. Mm-hmm. I didn't know why he was the way he was. And I remember just the cackle of his voice and the dissonance of his voice. And then I would draw him. If I drew him, I would understand him more, even though I never really saw the movies.
And
like,
that
fully.
He was fantasy.
And
as
that
well.
He was fantasy, yeah. And that was my way into kind of like fully just embracing them as friends as opposed to being terrified.
That's fantastic. Took
his power away. Yeah. It's pretty cool. I mean, obviously it had an effect. I just realized. In case it's Freddy Krueger. But you know, we're all roughly the same age, and for all of us on this side of the table, we grew up on the, you know, the VHS side. I just told the story about the punk rocker guy. Did you guys have that growing up, but being able to have access to all these movies at your local video store, watch them with friends or family, or what do you remember about that time period?
Sure. Yeah, well, video. I worked in video stores as soon as they would hire me, and you know, probably could describe the box of almost any film that you could throw at me. But and I think I often am troubled by how young people today. I can't believe I just used that phrase.
We call it the get off my lawn phrase. Get off my lawn, because we say it quite frequently. We're like, we don't know how youngsters pick out movies nowadays.
Oh, that's funny. I think when I was 20, I said, if I ever say young people today, kill me. So someone's going to burst through the doors and kill me now. But in all honesty, I mean, it's now that we live in a time when you can access anything in seconds, I find that the younger generation is dramatically less educated about film and literature than we were when I was growing up, when it was difficult to get these things. You know, like when I remember when the first VCR was on the market, and I remember going to rent a movie with my mother and my stepfather. Tootsie was our first.
That's great.
But, you know, you'd have to drive like 40 minutes and leave like a $300 deposit. And, you know, you really thought carefully about what movie you were going to see, and then you'd watch it start to finish. Now when you can click and it's there, they don't watch anything.
And you don't get the value either of holding a box.
Yeah.
And like really analyzing the box and like hyper-analyzing the publicity stills and trying to figure out if that's the movie for you. You know,
you're way more proactive, right? Like there's an investigation, a research when you found that one filmmaker and you're like, I got to find others. Right. You had to look at the boxes to find them. You couldn't go on IMDb and click their name.
Going to a record store.
I don't know how people date anymore, because that was like how I got to know.
Swipe left, swipe right.
No, because when I was like high school, even into college, college. Like, you ask the person out, and then you go to the video store together to pick out the movie. And you spend an hour circling going, you watch this? Well, what about this? Hey, that's do you like so this? True. And that's how you got to know the person. Yeah. And then you'd, like, swing by and get ice cream and go not watch that movie. there was a whole lot that went into picking that movie.
Yeah, that's true.
And so I don't know. Maybe you do that in front of Redbox.
I think Elric and I had this discussion where you'd be more invested if you spent all this time renting a movie. Like, if you watch a movie on Netflix for 20 minutes, you're like, I'm not into this, you'll turn it off. But, like, if you spent an hour at the store, picked it out, you're like, well, I'm watching this. Yeah. Totally. I'm finishing it. My night, that's it.
Totally. Well, what Dan's talking about, like, when getting a VCR, my family, we had to rent. We didn't own a VCR. We had to rent one.
Really?
You know? Oh, yeah, wow. We had to rent a VCR. And so my dad would rent it, put down a deposit for the VCR. And then I remember the first two titles were Critters and Nightmare on Elm Street that he rented. He wanted to make sure he watched those first. And then I got to see Critters, but not Nightmare on Elm Street. But, yeah, it's a commitment because once you slap down that amount of money to, like, put a hold on a VCR, it's like, damn right you're going to watch those movies.
Yeah. So my parents had one of the very first, they still have it because my parents never replace anything. They still have one of the very first VCRs that ever came out in the early 80s. It is the size of a microwave, and to eject the entire top lifts off the machine. It comes up.
It's like a DeLorean.
And it's got a remote, but the remote is tethered to it. So it's like, I got a remote, but only 3 feet.
Yeah. That's fantastic.
They still have it, and it sits, my parents still have a console TV like in the wooden case. And
beautiful.
It sits on top of it with, and I've told them, I'm like, whenever you guys, you know, shuffle off this mortal coil, I'm taking that thing.
Is it operational?
It's fully operational.
That's, I don't know how
my
that's
dad
possible.
Would still call people to fix it if
that's
it broke.
Amazing.
That's my dad. So,
And those head cleaners are really important now
oh
if
my
you
gosh.
Still have a VCR. Because they don't make them anymore.
I still have my VCR because there are so many horror films that you can only watch on VCR. Yeah. So I still have mine. And the place in North Hollywood, Eddie Brandt's, if your VCR breaks, they will repair it for free because it's worth it for them to keep your VCR functional.
Yeah.
So anytime it gets busted, you just go there.
That's crazy. There's so many bored millennials right now.
I know.
What are they all talking about?
Well, I'm curious. I mean, like, we're all of the same age, and what I'm kind of fighting against and kind of trying to grasp right now is me as a horror fan now at 40, you know, and how I perceive the genre. And some people can hear me talk about it and go, oh, you're so jaded. Oh, and I'm like, no, I want better. Yeah. I'm looking for that. I'm not looking for nostalgia. I'm just looking for better quality, you know?
Completely agree.
You know, how are you guys evolving as, you know, horror fans, not men who work in the industry, you know?
Yeah, like finding stuff. Like is it word of mouth, going to festivals? How do you find good horror movies these days?
Oh, man. I mean, I think it's a mix of word of mouth. Some of it's festivals. I see a lot at Fantastic Fest and other festivals. And it's also just knowing other filmmakers. Mm-hmm. It's knowing where to look online. I mean, it's kind of an amalgam of all these different places. Well, and I feel like quality is something you can see a mile away.
I totally agree.
Or you get a sense of what something's going to be, or at least what you're looking for.
Right.
I think
it
kind of reveals itself pretty quickly because the bad movies are pretty obviously bad.
Yeah.
You know?
But taste-wise, have you found that your tastes have shifted drastically, or are you guys pretty much that 5-year-old kid who used to, you know?
I think my taste became more sophisticated as I got older. Mm-hmm. By the time I was, you know, a teenager and I was exposed to the horror movies of the 70s, so like The Omen and The Exorcist, movies that took the subject matter seriously and weren't just simply there to sort of shock and awe or using the exploitation elements to drive the story, that's when I realized that it could be art.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's from there on out, those became my preferred films to look for. But I think the thing about being a horror fan is you're ultimately a fan of all of it.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was Stephen King who said, and I've said this before, but I think Stephen King said to be a fan of horror is to be a fan of shit because most of it is.
Totally, yeah.
And you have to like literally watch so much to get to the good stuff, but there's good stuff in there. You know?
It's weird how forgiving we are of the horror genre. Like, you wouldn't put on a drama that has terrible acting and be like, I got to push through because there might be a really dramatic beat.
Yeah.
But you watch horror, you're like, but there might be a cool kill coming up. I don't know.
Totally.
Or something.
And then we talk about like some of these releases, like The Mutilator, the release that got, it's got like, and pieces, they get these like five, you know, Criterion type releases.
So good.
But the movies themselves are really, you know, shit.
We're thankful.
Yeah. But with little, glorious moments to them. But I mean, you guys have a very eclectic taste. if I'm judging from the kind of film SpectreVision mm-hmm. is interested in, when we our first well, I know for me, our first kind of exposure to what you guys were doing, I ran Jump Cut Cafe, which was a little place in the valley.
Oh, yeah.
And one of the first movies, well, not that we showed, but first film that you guys did was Toad Road.
Yeah, I remember
we had this,
that.
This
yeah.
little intimate screening of that. Wow. But everyone yeah. was kind of, who went to it was kind of fucked up by it because
we were forever changed.
It was, a little
like, it was small, so I don't want to overhype that we, you know, we're probably, it was probably like 15 people or something.
Sure, sure.
But everyone who was there was experienced, I think from the poster, you're thinking, oh, it's going to be like, it looks like Twin Peaks-y or something.
Very disturbing. Yeah.
And then you're kind of watching kids, and then it turns into something that feels like a really interesting Blair Witchy kind of thing.
Real mm-hmm. at the same time. Mm-hmm. And
it was just an unusual film, and I think everyone there enjoyed that they saw it. Like, it was just one of those weird experiences.
Well, I think when it ended and we saw... It's been a while. Is there a title card about the lead actress at the end? That's what it was. So it was an intimate, I don't know, 15, 20 of mm-hmm. us sitting in this little room, this little cafe, watching it. Kind of into it, not sure what we were experiencing. You almost feel like you're watching home videos that you're not supposed to be watching.
Yeah. Yeah. They get increasingly hypnotic as it goes.
You are.
And then by the third like act of it, when it gets all dreamy and stuff and the actress kind of disappears from it, Sarah. Mm-hmm. And then you see that title card, and then the lights went up. And it was I've never had this screening experience because, you know, in a theater, it's different. But we're in a little cafe, and there's 20 of us, and like Elric just gets up, and he's like, what did you guys think of that? And like we had this little huddle and just talked about the film and how we felt about it. It just felt really...
Something that's missing from when you just see a movie that's perfectly clean. It's like sometimes you see a great movie... you don't want to be a filmmaker anymore because it was perfect.
You can't do it.
Kind of something that has edges and warts. Sure. I want to do that.
Well, Toad Road, important to note, we didn't make that film.
Right.
You know, we acquired it, but we
presented it.
Yeah. So.
But would anyone know what it is? Otherwise, it did feel like you guys were lending your name behind it.
Yeah. Well, I hope that helped. You know, we programmed it at SpectreFest, which, to answer your earlier question about, you know, where we first see or hear about new horror films, I think. We, you know, because we're always planning our festival, we get a really early look at a lot of movies, which is a really great privilege, you know. But Toad Road, I remember watching that with absolutely no context at all. Yeah. I think I knew it had played at Fantasia and it had gotten a really good review. And yeah, like you guys, within 60 seconds, knew this was something I'd never seen before. And I don't know how much you know about how Jason works. Jason Banker, but it actually is largely a documentary. I'd say, he'll never say exactly what percent of it was fiction. It's like 70-30, but the lines between reality and fiction are totally blurred in that film, and that extends to the reality surrounding the film, which is that Sarah passed away from an accidental overdose, I think right after the movie had either premiered, or it was just a very, very devastating event for all of them. But it is, I remember when we screened it at CineFamily, similar reaction. People were very silent when the film was over. Mm-hmm. I remember Lily was totally fucked up by it, because if you have any firsthand experience with drug abuse, either yourself or someone you know, I think that Toad Road just gets inside you and. It really hits all the things that are so terrifying about.
Well, the way it sucks you in, the early montage of the footage is just people getting fucked up.
Yeah.
Beyond
yeah.
recognition. You can identify with it, but it's scary.
It's totally lighting the pubic hairs on fire.
Yeah, that's right.
And the horror elements of it, I think, are really terrifying, too. Yeah. But I was almost more disturbed by watching people lose themselves.
Same.
Well, we old show, we talked about how Cannibal Holocaust works so well on you is because it blurs that line. You watch a real turtle die, but then, so when something happens to a person, that little smoke and mirrors has worked on you.
Yeah.
And I feel a similar thing with that, like that blurring. That can be pretty disturbing. But so what came first then, SpectreFest or SpectreVision for you guys? Where is it?
SpectreVision came first, the company. We started it 6 years ago? Is it seven now?
I mean, we all spit in our hands and shook it in 2010.
Right.
So, but we didn't really – we spent 2 years just quietly developing a bunch of projects. So 2012 was when we announced the company.
Mm-hmm. Did you guys meet working? Oh, sorry.
I was just going to say, how did you initially – because obviously, you know, you're a writer and you're an actor. And how did you all kind of meet each other?
Together? Yeah. Waller and I have been friends for roughly 20 years, and we had a project that I wrote that he was directing that Elijah was attached to star in, and that it was a comedy. It never happened, although there's talk of it happening again now. but the three of us just became close and discovered that we had this shared love of horror.
Yeah, we'd sort of initially meet to talk about this film and discuss the production and moving forward with it. And these meetings quickly turned into just friend hangouts. And then we would just discuss everything else. And a lot of that discussion was movies. And a lot of it ended up being about genre and horror films. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I had kind of been separately wanting to start a company. I'd wanted to get involved in production and really coming from the standpoint of just loving the filmmaking process and wanting to support filmmakers that I loved and the kinds of films that I'd like to see made.
Now, was there a particular director that you worked with that kind of helped push that inspiration a little bit? Or?
That's a good question. No, I don't think so. I think the older I got, the more I felt like my love of what I do as an actor is driven more from a place of loving filmmaking rather than just simply wanting to facilitate a role or to sort of engage in just simply that vocation. I just love the process. I love the collaboration. I love a group of people getting together because they have a shared vision for something and they're trying to see it through with something hopefully at the end that you're all very proud of. Yeah. So, yeah, I think it was just a growing thing in me the older I got. And, you know, again, yeah, we met and we discussed this shared mutual love of horror films, and I really had this love of the genre. And we connected specifically on these, at the time, movies that weren't really being made widely in the U.S. Mm. It felt like the kinds of movies that we were connecting to, like Let the Right One In or We Are What We Are or, you know, the great sort of horror movies from France a number of years ago, like Inside and Martyrs.
Mm-hmm. The Orphanage.
And The Orphanage, yeah. These movies were the kinds of movies that we loved and represented the best, we thought, of the horror genre. And we just wanted to provide a place. It was almost coming out of this place of frustration. Yeah. Like, why isn't there a place here in the U.S. that is geared towards specifically making only these kinds of films and supporting these kinds of filmmakers? Now, we're living in a really pretty excellent time, I think, in regards to that those kinds of films, and there's been a great sort of, you know, resurgence of it. But that was really the inspiration, I think.
Yeah. And I think, you know, remember that Waller and I were like, does Elijah keep mentioning starting a company? Like, just ask us out already, man. And there was no turning back at that point.
Yeah.
And how did that lend to SpectreFest? Was it just out of passion of wanting to share the cool shit you were coming across?
That came also just out of an organic relationship with Hadrian and Cinefamily.
I had known Hadrian back from when he was at Cinephile? Yeah, Cinephile. And I used to come in and I'd go, hey, I've got these really rare movies. You want to trade me for free rentals? And, you know, I know. The store's great. So then when he started up Cinefamily, I would just go over there. And I think, you know, one time he was like, what are you up to? And I mentioned it. And initially we met at Cantor's, if you remember, and just about us, like, programming a night for their Halloween stuff. And then I think, you know, we started sending him ideas, and he was like, there's a lot of good ideas here. Maybe we should give you a little more real estate. And then the first year was out of control. I don't know if you guys remember. It was called Nightmare City, the first. And it was 77 events in 30 days. And by the way, I'm so glad that happened.
Was that part of the 50 states of horror
That was the video nasties we showed one at midnight.
That's right. Yeah.
In ascending order of difficulty. So number one was Cannibal Holocaust. Yeah. And if you made it, there were like these little tickets that people could punch if they actually saw all 30. Right. They would win a prize.
It was super cool.
Yeah, I remember when you first announced Nightmare City and I got the press release for it. And I was like, wait a minute, they're showing Nightmare City?
I know.
Like 50 to 70 times? That's a lot of love for Nightmare City. That was a good year. That was fun.
It was a good year.
I went at the time, and I went to like most of those showings just because I kept thinking, I'm never going to come out again. I'm never going to leave the house again. I'm going out at midnight.
Oh, that's so cool.
And I ended up at most of them.
We also programmed, last year you programmed Hour of the Wolf, which is a favorite of mine.
Me too.
And so what I like about that, that's what I come back to, because I feel like I have a pretty eclectic taste, you know, between art house and horror, and I feel like the intersection's where a lot of cool stuff happens.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm just curious, like, what are you guys looking for? And I can tell, you know, from that you're looking for something different when you're looking for films to pick up or projects. Sure. What is the intangibles that you guys are always trying to beautifully make tangible. It is very intangible.
We talk about it all the time, and we've never been able to define it. We're always looking for, like, if we could just distill it to a, mm-hmm. a phrase, or and then we'll, like, we'll think we have it, and we'll go, oh, wait, that doesn't apply to the boy. Wait, wait.
Yeah.
It's kind of a you know it when you see it thing. But I know a big part of what drives us is wanting to get behind movies that probably wouldn't exist if we didn't help with them. And
like black and white Iranian vampire films. Which I remember hearing about so much earlier from the, you know, initial press release. It was months
I saw the I think I'm allowed to say this. I went to a very, 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 very early rough cut screening of it because a friend of mine is friend of you guys.
Very interesting.
Like a 3-hour version of it.
Yeah.
Like really rough. Yeah. And I liked it a lot just on that initial viewing. Sure. But definitely, it was what was funny was on the way out, my friend that I went with is my buddy Scott Reynolds. He's a screenwriter. And we both argued about what should be like. Mm-hmm. There is a thing in the ending that lost me where I was like, oh, I don't like that. I lose the lead character when he does this event, which doesn't matter because it's not in the movie now anyway. Yeah. And I was like, if they cut that out, I think the movie would be great. He's like, no, but that's the whole point of the movie. It's like, when that happens, now he can be with the girl because whatever. So it was funny that we got in this argument and then like a year later seeing the truncated version and it felt familiar, but it felt like a completely different experience.
Yeah. I think that's, you know, big, like I've said this before, and I'm sure, you know, those of you who make films, until a film in the editing is pretty close to the version it's going to be, it's pretty much unbearable to watch. Like it goes from 0 to 60. It's not a gradual improvement. And
right. Yeah.
So I remember those early cuts and they were hard, you know, because all films are hard
Were particularly difficult too, because Lily had a vision that was far more expansive in regards to the storytelling. So there were characters in that cut that didn't make the final cut of the film.
Right.
Because she populated it like a universe. She sort of built this universe, built backstories for all these people. And so that's beautiful on the page, and it's incredible to film, and they were amazing. She was killing her darlings. Like, they were great sequences, but they didn't all serve the narrative, you know?
Right.
And I liked the simplicity by the end. By the end, it felt very refined. And,
oh, absolutely.
And we seeing it on a big screen, I felt bad at once because it was limited, right? I think we saw it down to Santa Monica at the New Art, and I felt bad for people after that because I was like, oh, this is really a big screen. This is a really the scope of a Western,
right?
And very specific, totally. and just, I don't know, this gorgeous little movie. But it seems like such a strange movie to like find in the first place, especially if it isn't even been cut down. Like, how did it even come into your radar? Because it wouldn't have been a festival.
Through two mutual friends.
Yeah, each of us, oddly, coincidentally, we each knew someone who was involved with it, and pretty much at the same time, we were both approached. And
My friend Sherry Devani, who's a first AD. And who's dear friends with Lily, she emailed me or called me and said, I know what you guys are looking for. I have a sense of the company that you guys are starting. And my friend Lily's about to direct this Iranian vampire film.
And you're like, we're
sold. And it's going to be in black and white. And I was just, I was besotted with the notion immediately. And you knew Mojan
Morneau, who plays the prostitute. And it's exactly the same conversation. We both got it at the same time. And it was one of the, I think I met her first.
I think you did.
Yeah, we met at Doughboys. And it was one of those things where I'm sure, you know, you have this, right, where you sit down and within 5 minutes you're like, this is a major, major filmmaker. Like you just knew. Yeah. She was so clear about what she wanted and who she is. And
never wavered.
Never. No. Mm. And actually the scene that you're talking about that was cut, which I'm assuming is the murder. When Arash murders the prostitute. This is a big credit to Lily. We did not want her to cut that. I think we were convinced that it was that the movie would lose its punch if he didn't kill someone as the girl had killed.
Right.
She was adamant about cutting it, and she was completely right.
Yeah, she was right completely right. Of the way.
Yeah,
yeah. It brings validity to that argument I had because it's a good moment, and it does make narrative sense, and it gives a reason for those two characters to end up together. But at the same time, I'm just kind of like that old school, like, I don't know, it's a movie, I want a happy ending.
Sure. You
know? So the way it ended I thought was equally appropriate. Mm-hmm. But in context, I assume it's different with every filmmaker in every film, but comparatively, I mean, is that the approach? Do you work with a filmmaker? Is there a long cut of a movie? Like, what's the collaborative process between you guys and the filmmaker themselves? And how do you figure out what's going to be best for the final product?
That's a great question. It's different every time. Yeah. It really is a different it's a different animal. It's a different group of people with, you know, a different set of ideas as to what the final film should be. So, you know, what the initial rough cut is versus what another person's rough cut is and how much work it needs and where it needs to go is always a different experience, which is part of the magic of it. Yeah, I don't know that there's anything that you know, we are as collaborative as we need to be for the film. You know, we are certainly very, very collaborative with our filmmakers and are there for them. But Lily's a great example in the sense that we knew that she had a very clear vision for the movie and that this was going to be something that a lot of the times we would need to sort of step away from it to see her, allow her to have her space to make the movie. Other filmmakers are very much involved together as a sort of, you know, collaboration from the very beginning. So it's different every time.
Yeah, it's very different. I mean, Cooties was incredibly collaborative. Mm-hmm. I mean, it genuinely felt like a large group of people made the film.
Completely.
And it's a larger scope, too.
Sure.
And it's a larger, because you're balancing comedy and horror. I mean, like everything seems to be a tonal dance with each of the movies.
That's interesting.
Yeah. You know, even Greasy Strangler, you know? I mean,
that's a tonal dance, all right.
And that's and Jim is another example of Lily. I mean, there was a certain point in the editorial process where the three of us said, he knows what he wants.
Yeah.
We don't see it yet, but he does. Yeah. And let's just get out of the way.
And more importantly, that he's a great example of someone who, we read the script. I was familiar, some of us were familiar with his work prior. So you read the script and then you know his work and you're like, okay, I can see this. And so you just know. As we were watching the cut, it's his universe. Mm-hmm. Like, no one's going to tell him to make that shift any other direction that is going to make it fit within a box that we are familiar with. That he operates in his own space, and that's what we all signed up for.
Because if you do, it's going to be sabotaged, right?
Absolutely. Yeah,
it's like that Ty West story about the Cabin Fever 2. Remember, he was like it was like a different comedian telling his jokes, and it just didn't work anymore.
Oh, that's great.
When somebody takes it out of your hands or recuts it,
absolutely.
But also, I think if there was any interference, it would also not feel genuine to the voice either.
Of course,
it wouldn't feel like even if it was like an attempt at like Daniel saying maybe you going, well, it'd be really great if there was a joke. It would not be on par with whatever he was going for. You know, you would be able to identify that.
You know, I think
that
most artists start out as mimics.
Yeah.
And you know, eventually what we all strive for is that what you're mimicking is your truth.
Mm-hmm.
Your experience of being alive. And with Jim, I think, you know, as the movie was coming together and posed, it was so alien. Like, we would say, like, you know, are there things we can do to maybe pull it back in a little bit?
Yeah, our natural filmic impulses didn't necessarily jive with what he was trying to do. Yeah. And I think once we realized that, it was kind of beautiful. We just stepped back.
Absolutely. And there was a great moment. I know for me, the big realization was that I remember I had a note about the cutting, the pace of the cutting was that just the cut, literally cutting between actors within a scene. I'd say tighten those cuts. There's like this dead air, and he'd go, "This is the way I want it." And it really wasn't until Sundance, seeing it with the audience, that I got it. Part of what he does is he makes you suffer through time.
Yeah.
That's part of what Jim Austin does.
It's meant to be uncomfortable.
It's meant to be
like
uncomfortable.
Like Todd Solondz.
Even the title,
like
the title, the Greasy Strangler's up way too long. Yeah. You know? He's telling you right away, like, everything you think you know about how movies are paced does not apply.
And it's so deliberate.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
And I like how in that instance, Sundance is basically your test audience.
Yeah,
which is a scary like you're gonna like go to Winnetka and go, all right, so you're gonna see an unfinished Greasy Strangler. The effects aren't finished.
Yeah, here's a beanie everyone gets a beanie.
Yeah, here's your scorecard.
Yeah.
But every filmmaker is different. I mean, some thrive on screenings and others are like, I don't want that noise in my head, you know.
And I think as producers it's also about adaptation. You know, adapting to the different scenarios and feeling like understanding how best to serve that particular movie so that it ends in the result that you all hope it to be. And I think it's different every time.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Cooties a little bit because
I love
horror, like all horror movies, but I tend to be in, I love horror comedies. I just don't, I don't like taking things seriously and I like having a lot of fun with it.
We love them.
Although
too.
There's the most horrific thing ever, which I know Bekah will agree with me.
Yeah, we agreed. The opening scene.
The opening scene with the origin of a chicken nugget it has to be the most disgusting thing ever put to, you almost lost me in that first minute. God, I hope I can make it past this opening credit scene. And then
it was like trauma-esque for me.
Oh, fantastic. It's
like, that's the best thing he's ever heard. It's from
like green goo out of the chicken nugget, and I was like, "Oh man, that's this funny. Is intense."
That was entirely created by Carrie and John. That was their thing, and it's so great to start the movie that way because after that sequence, it's pretty light for a while.
It is. And it gets and fun. So it's
and nice to like hit everybody with something pretty vile so that you get a sense of the movie that you're in.
The amazing thing with, you know, with they're shooting with a macro lens and that fly landed.
And like takes
and
a
took
shit.
A shit that's in the movie. A fly shitting.
But what were your reactions to Lee's script when you first got it? Because I'm sure on the page it must have been funny too, but I don't know. I watched the movie, and as soon as he pops in the movie, I was like, did he write this totally so he could play this role? Because he's just so good. Yeah.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah, he totally did.
Yeah. Again, that was, you know, when you have Ian Brennan and Lee Whannell, you just get out of their way. You know, and the first draft that came in, we were beside ourselves.
Yeah.
We couldn't believe it. And it's also a rare thing of a comedy that reads funny. I think a lot of times you're going, oh, I see how this will be funny once it's actually on its feet.
Contextual.
Yeah, but I'm not experiencing the desire to laugh. While that script, you would laugh out loud when you were reading it. And I don't remember there being many revisions, or I think it was pretty...
We danced around different endings for a while.
That we did.
We talked a lot about different endings. Yeah. Mainly for budgetary reasons. So there were like six different endings that they wrote that were really well-crafted, interesting, totally different directions that for whatever reason, based on budget that we thought we were going to have or were aiming for, we'd have to either pare down or make larger. So that was something that we talked a lot about.
And I think, you know, if there's a common thread with all the films, or and just film in general, is that there is, with Cooties, and I like to think with everything we do, there is a really genuine emotional center. These are real people who have real problems and real feelings. And the you know, what my favorite scene in Cooties, I think, is the scene with you and Allison in the library where you confess that you're, you know, you actually are a teacher, not a writer, you know, and she's crying, and you get those are the scenes I think that elevate the goofiness, and even Greasy Strangler is surprisingly moving. Yeah. I think the relationship between the father and son is really tender in the end, surprisingly.
Yeah.
Now, what was it like to have that many kids in the scenes? Because usually if you're trying to budget a film, you don't have kids because they can only work for like 6 hours at a time and you have to hire teachers. And
we keep doing that to ourselves.
Yeah, for those listening at home, kids are a whole thing when you have them in a film set. It's like a whole nother bag. So
you're absolutely right. I don't remember that being too restrictive. We shot in summer. That was part of it. There was also a fair amount to do on a daily basis without the kids. And then a lot of the hordes weren't kids. so that helped. Josh, you can actually speak to this even better than I can. I was...
Who?
Who?
Oh, 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 Josh Waller, third partner of SpectreVision.
Who? He's arrived.
He's entered.
He is here.
Welcome, Josh.
I like to come unfashionably late. I'm so unfashionable that it's fashionable. I think. I don't know.
Well, thank you for joining us.
Thanks. Thanks for
having me. We're talking about Cooties. We already did the video stores and all that stuff. So jump right in.
So quickly, one horror film that scared you when you're young.
Yeah, exactly. Elijah's right. It wasn't as big of a deal as it normally is. All the horror stories about like not only like casting kids but working with kids just kind of didn't play with Cooties. All the kids kind of came together really quickly, and then when we were shooting, it was summertime, and also, you know, you only get the kids for a short amount of time anyway, but film sets, you're not shooting the entire time. It's you know, so at the end of the day, it actually works out to probably the same amount of time you'd shoot if you were working with adults. Maybe a little bit less, but it's not too bad.
Was it trickier with the boy when with Jared being in, you know, almost every scene?
Boy was, you know, way tougher specifically for that reason. And also because he was getting schooled at the same time, so it wasn't summertime. Mm-hmm. You know, it was, I think we maybe got to shoot with Jared about 4 hours a day total.
Wow. And that was shot overseas, right?
That was shot in Colombia.
Yes,
so. And that is more to your point.
Right? Yeah. No child labor laws down there? How's that work? Yeah. That's why you shut down the
two. Oh, we tried. We tried.
Yeah, they say to never shoot with kids and animals.
Yeah.
But we just do it anyway. Yeah.
We've got a gorilla in one of our movies.
No. We have a gorilla in one of our scripts. Oh, we don't have a gorilla in one of our movies. Yeah, there's a big difference.
Well, the director would like there to be a gorilla. Yeah. Let's put it that way.
Well, I want to see just who, I mean, like in terms of like the legwork and who calls what? Who's doing the line producing? Who's on set? Who's handling with, you know, any of the kind of deal making? Do you guys split it up or is it all equal?
One of the ways we're able to be as prolific as I think we've been is that we're constantly discussing protocols and dividing responsibilities. And you know, I think we believe organization is the key to productivity. Oh, yeah. So, just sort of in order of the assembly line, I, Daniel, run development. So, you know, that can be anything from, you know, managing all the submissions that are coming in and you know, proactively seeking
working
out.
With writers.
Yeah, working with writers. And sometimes the script comes in and it's like with Lily and A Girl Walks Home Alone at Night, we didn't have a single note. And then on the opposite end of the spectrum, Cooties, which was Waller's idea, you know, was something we were involved with all the way.
Right.
I put the package together, the director, the cast, and then the financing sometimes, although Lisa Whalen, our new CEO, is increasingly handling that stuff, which is nice.
Yay, Lisa.
So once it's done, I hand it off to Waller, who runs production.
Yeah.
And when the movie is finished, Elijah, will sort of lead the publicity charge. Right. But all that said, all three of us are very involved in every single thing.
Yeah. Didn't know if there were like strengths than others.
I sort of manage the creative vision of the company. Yeah. You know, if it was to be sort of defined.
Yeah,
definitely. And so there are definitely defined roles. I think there are also defined personalities amongst the three of us that I think have, you know, strengths that sort of lend themselves to different aspects of what it is that we do. But we also we oversee everything.
Yeah.
We look at everything. We have to be unanimous in agreeing on everything. So it's
this point, I think, you know, we know each other so well that you really, like, any one of the three of us can go into a situation and represent the communal point of view.
Completely.
I think what's important is not to like embrace your strengths, but to embrace your weaknesses.
Oh, absolutely.
That's okay to do that. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't have to be one of those producers that does everything. In fact, most good producers that I know don't do everything.
Sure,
they have their strengths and then they delegate responsibility to, you know, people that they trust.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, between the three of us, like Lige was saying, I mean, the three of us could not be any more different people. And somehow we just kind of came together as friends. And I think that what works for us is that unanimous thing. Like, I think if we were a democracy between the three of us, we wouldn't work. It really wouldn't work, but it has to be unanimous. And if something gets through the filter that is the three of us, three very different tastes, then it's like, well, that's something that we really want to see.
And we have rules, you know, like, you know, if you don't like something, you have to say why. You know, that's
totally.
You're not allowed to just go no. Like, it's a constant discussion.
That's come up with me a lot. That's come up with me a lot. I'll get a script and I'll say no.
Well,
you have to explain.
Yeah, and I err on the other side.
It's a great exercise.
I'll get really excited about something and I'll just completely forget to tell anybody that I'm doing it. He's
like, hey, you know that project we start next week? What?
Tinder's gone rogue.
Yeah. Well, a big part of that, you know, you're asking about where material comes from too, is something we often talk about is, and I think this is I bet you'll agree, Ryan, I think this is a fairly unique approach in development. So we're always saying, and we tell our readers too, don't read the movie on the page. Read the movie that could be. Mm-hmm. And because I can tell you, for me, I don't really do writing for hire much anymore, but when I did, I would have this incredibly frustrating experience of someone would pass on something, and I'd say, why? Was there any feedback? And it would be like, well, they didn't really like that one. Like, there's that sequence in the third act, and I go, well, but I can change that. Yeah, that doesn't make any sense to me that they're mm-hmm. passing on the whole. They really loved it, you're telling me, but they pass because they don't like one thing. So I we try really hard to not be that way, that's definitely my like you said, embracing your weaknesses. One of my weaknesses is I will read for the movie that could be, mm-hmm. and I'll kind of forget to explain what that is.
That's true.
Yeah.
And my weakness
is very endearing. Then
my rule is I can't talk to people.
Yeah. In fact, can you cut his mic?
It's like I know it's kind of like the guy, the mad dog, and it's like, okay, we can do it. We can make the movie and let him off. And I just break through walls. And
he's the gimp. You're the gimp. That's awesome.
That's fine.
Well, I love that. You know, Waller is ex-military. Waller was in the Marines, and you've taught me a tremendous amount about how to apply those ideas to creativity.
Sure.
You and I have talked about the different kinds of generals. Do you want to?
in terms of like the way that the military is structured, you know, like and officers, there's, you know, the field side, you know, and then there's everyone that's going out there and like fighting the battles. But then there's also generals that are never out on the battlefield. Mm-hmm. There's generals that are always in an office, you know, in a more like a bureaucratic position. And so, like, I'm fine with, you know, my partners being the generals that
that
go in and do that. And I'm fine with being the general that's like, I don't want to be a diplomat. I would be the worst diplomat ever. but I am the guy who I would like to be out, you know, with a chisel and a hammer and sure. breaking down like boulders and stuff.
Well, and running a set.
Well, which yeah.
which is a metaphor for running set.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things that are metaphors.
It's funny. This is like the third conversation in which your ex-military past has come up, and I've never asked when, where, like what.
He was a child soldier.
Trying to figure out, like, you know.
Toy soldiers, man.
I mean, clearly. No, it was nothing. You know, fortunately for me...
Well, it was something.
It was something, yeah.
I enlisted in the Corps because it was a bit of a family tradition.
Yeah.
And I knew I wanted to be involved with film, but mm-hmm. the thought of moving to Hollywood
right.
and just being like, let's go for it, didn't make sense to me. So I joined the Marines instead. And... fortunately for me, when I enlisted, it was during Desert Storm in 92. And by the time I got out of boot camp, that war was over because it was like 24 hours anyways.
Didn't your contract expire like 2 months before September 11th?
Yeah, like a few months before, in February before September 11th, it expired. Man. So it was mostly the reserves for me. And, and then was like, wow, that was... You know, there's always that bit of you, I think, for people that were in the military and you train and you never have to go to battle. Like, mm-hmm. do I have it in me?
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. to actually, if I had had to go. And then you're like, well, thank God I didn't have to test myself in that way.
Right. Mm-hmm. I'm always fascinated because, I mean, you know, a lot of the guys who came up through the 1950s horror films, you know, they were all in it, you know, and Savini was a war photographer, you know. Yeah, mm-hmm. a lot of the guys served.
Yeah, Sam Fuller. Mm-hmm.
And I'm always curious, you know, in terms of like the guys who shift from that, you know, real world danger into the genre and embrace it. And, you know, I mean, I'm just always fascinated by it. So
I think it's more like like Dan said, it's like the structural aspects.
Yeah.
It's like, what's interesting, I think where a lot of like artists get lost is that like artists maybe shouldn't have to have structure in themselves.
Yeah.
You know, like that's why like people have managers and representatives to kind of like help wrangle artists. But, you know, it's helped me to be able to kind of take all of my own ideas that I have as a creative and try to put it into some kind of... It's been tremendously helpful. And it's been really helpful in terms of, like, working a set. Because it always comes down to, you know, respect first and just trusting the people that you work with. Mm-hmm. and trusting that they're going to handle their own individual departments. Like, I don't need to tell you how to run G&E. Like, that's not my department. That's your department. Just mm-hmm. do a good job. Mm-hmm. Because if it's not a good job, I'm going to come down on you. Not you. You know what I mean?
Looking over it, because of how eclectic your slate is in it, I don't see anything in the filmography that's like, oh, we'll do this one for us and this one for them just so we can keep going. But our last guests were Scream Factory, and, you know, they talk about how they keep going as a financial model. Sure. Like, they'll have their John Carpenter releases or The Babadook, mm-hmm. and then they can release a bunch of obscure titles that they really want to do. So how's mm-hmm. it work being, you know, production and distributors, as you guys are, when you're choosing which films to put out, and how do we keep going, what kind of deals you're finding in the new marketplace? Because mm-hmm. I know there's some Chiller. You had some with Chiller, right? Or
we did one with Chiller. The yeah. Boy, yeah. Well, we're not distributors.
You don't distribute
our own. Okay. We do something called SpectreVision Presents, which is we did LFO, Toad Road, and now Belladonna of Sadness, which yeah. just opened in New York. And
this weekend at CineFamily.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Oh, cool.
That is May 13th, that is.
I think, you know, the biggest thing that we did, and we look, I personally had no inkling that I would ever be a producer. That would, like, if 10 years ago when I was, you know, a screenwriter and you know, trying to raise money to direct a movie, if someone had said, you're going to be a producer, I would have thought that was preposterous. So we've kind of, and that's true for all of us, really. I mean, you know, we've had to kind of learn as we go, and I think one of the smartest things we ever did was we realized that the longer we could put off being funded as a company, the more time we would have to establish our identity mm-hmm. without anyone kind of pulling the strings, pulling mm-hmm. puppet strings. Mm-hmm. So the first thing most fledgling companies do is they go out, they get an investor, they open up an office, they hire a bunch of people. It feels great. It feels real. And then they go out of business a year later. We used to joke we were like the Lincoln Lawyer of production companies, just like, you know, three guys, a car, and a dream. And we still don't have an office.
That's very true.
We meet at Le Pan Quotidien on Melrose is our office. But we mm-hmm. for us it's been about keeping the costs down and not, you know, we operate more like a real company now. We have staff and because it got to the point where literally we couldn't do it. We were literally doing everything, all three of us. So I think that, you know, the secret to that has been just to keep what it costs to run SpectreVision or to keep SpectreVision in business is as small as it can be all the time. Mm-hmm. Now, it's no longer $0, but it's still, we're very modest with the way that we, you know, just the kind of accoutrements that, you know, that you would normally expect to have having a company.
Mm-hmm. I think. I'm curious for Elijah, you know, because obviously you've acted in some of the films, like you're in Cooties mm-hmm. and Open Windows. Do you get attached to a certain like, why are you not in every SpectreVision film? Like, how do you?
Why?
Why? Why, sir?
It's your company. You could throw that gauntlet down. I was like, I'm going to be in every one of them.
Yeah. And how do you balance it?
But yeah, how do you figure out which ones you do? Like, how does that work? Is it based on the filmmaker saying, I have a part that I think you'd be great for in this? And, you know.
Well, initially when we started the company, I was very clear that I didn't want to be in any of them.
Right.
I just wanted this to be a pure venture. I didn't want it to seem like a vanity project. It wasn't a means to create work for myself. It was a means to support films that I wanted to see made. And I wanted to make that very clear. So Cooties, I had to be convinced. I had to be kind of like dragged through the mud a little bit. It wasn't because I didn't love it, and I loved the script and was, you know, genuinely enthusiastic about the movie being made, of course, but it was just one of those things that I couldn't let go of that mandate and wanting to make sure that it was all integrity based, just wanting to make sure that there was a separation between my work as an actor and what we were doing. Mm-hmm. I ultimately relented and I don't regret it, and it was a great experience. That kind of loosened the straps a little bit, I think, for me. I think I realized that I didn't have to be so protective of the one thing, that there wouldn't necessarily be miscommunication in regards to the purity of one endeavor versus another. So I'm open to it now, and it's one of those things that if something does come up that with a filmmaker that I love or a particular script that I'm truly excited about and there is genuine interest, awesome. But I'm not – the one thing I'm not doing is looking for work as an actor to be in a SpectreVision film.
Oh, and if anything,
it's always an organic thing, and it often comes from the filmmaker, and often there's a sort of initial begrudging look at it. So I still – yeah, it's still difficult for me to make that decision. But, you know, there's a script that we have now that we're going to make probably next year that's brilliant, and a filmmaker whom I love, and – you know, that was the first time I didn't hesitate.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah.
Because I really think it's special. So it's very organic and not something I'm looking for.
And if anything, my opinion is that producing is kind of represents a move away from acting a little bit for you in that, you know, as
absolutely
often said, like, I don't know if I always want to do that. I like being on the other side of the camera too.
Sure.
But yeah, we had, you know, with Cooties, it really came down to we were funded. And we were all like, oh, God, he'd be so great as Clint, but no, he doesn't want to, you know, act in any of our movies. So, you know, we were exploring other options, and you know, the way movies are put together is largely built on the presale value of cast, and so that will often dictate your list of actors that you're considering for a particular role. So you start with, you know, 30 names, and then your foreign sales agent takes off 75% of those, and then of the ones that are left,
Van Damme,
there's some of them.
Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Van Damme, almost the Greasy Strangler.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Hey, don't knock Van Damme.
No, Behringer.
This sounds great overseas. We love it.
Behringer, oh, for sure.
Oh, yeah, I love
it. Yeah, Behringer. Oh, he's getting pitched. Oh, Behringer. What,
really?
You too?
Really?
Behringer, no.
Oh, I guess.
That's why I was
like, oh, it was you. Oh, sorry.
There was like AFM last year. Every single meeting I took was like, no, we're trying to get Kiefer Sutherland because he's selling big in Europe. Yeah. And we were like, really?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
It's a fickle market. It's own little
ecosystem.
Really fickle.
So anyway, so then you've got, you know, you've got 25% left, and then of those, many of them are like, you're never going to get this person, like, just don't bother.
Yeah,
and then,
Ryan Gosling's not going to be in Cooties.
Right, right, for example.
You never know.
So with Cooties, it literally came down, I think what finally convinced Elijah was we sat down and we were like, look, you're literally the only name that's left on the list. That's it. And you're perfect for the part. And Elijah finally went, okay. And I remember saying to you too, part of your job as a producer on this is to do whatever you have to get the movie made. Of course. And in this case, it's being in it.
Of course.
And then you said, okay, all right, okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, it's true.
That's pretty amazing.
I saw last year, guys, I wasn't at Fantastic Fest, but I looked it up, and you guys did the keynote speech.
Yeah.
I'm really curious what that was for you guys. Mm-hmm. What did you guys discuss? Because they always seem to have the most interesting events, and it seems like such a hub of like the fantastic in general.
Absolutely.
Which
absolutely
is why
as a witness to their keynote.
Oh, you were there for that? Okay,
it was excellent.
So just give us the cliff notes. Huh?
Yeah.
But what did you guys? What did you guys tackle there?
Wow, the keynote was terrifying. I don't love public speaking, but also like giving a presentation was something that we
yeah, you were
kind
so
of
nervous.
I was very,
very
nervous.
Cute.
Thanks, man. but basically what we did is we just contextualized who we are and what it is that we've done and what it is that we're trying to do.
And how we work.
And how we work.
We went through each of our roles, yeah, kind of like you guys asked, but just a little more in depth, you know, because you're talking to, you know, filmmakers from abroad and from here that just – they kind of want to know like how we're doing it, how we're making it. Are we making it? Mm-hmm. You know, but
and we just love Rodney and we love Kristen Bell and we love Fantastic Fest, and it feels like a home for us. So to be asked to be involved, you know, was a real honor. So it was great. I mean, we are there every year. That is a festival I can't miss. It's my favorite week of the year.
He'll make a shoot move their dates. I'm not even kidding.
It's short. I haven't met. Yeah, I would definitely try. It's just so special. There's nothing like it. You know, there are other great genre festivals for sure. Fantasia and Sitges and Morbido and, you know, the deceased Stanley Film Festival. But there's something very unique about Fantastic Fest in the sense that there's no separation between filmmakers and fans. It is a genuine celebration. It's not split up over multiple venues, so it's all in one place. So it feels like this full-on communal experience celebrating all that we love. And you're always introduced to movies that you never thought you would see, to filmmakers that you've admired, or new filmmakers that you're now suddenly blown away by something that you've seen, and you can literally see a movie that Jeremy Saulnier just made and go up to him in the bar after and have a drink. And it's genuine. We've made so many friends there.
And memories. It's camp. It's literally festival camp.
It is.
You know? Yeah. And it was funny because when I went to South by Southwest, I didn't realize that the Alamo Drafthouse South of Lamar was part of the stop.
And it feels different.
It feels different. I stood in the middle of the lobby and it turned into an 80s music video where I'm seeing ghosts of Fantastic Fest members walking by and I'm standing in the middle, turning around and spinning, going, where are all my friends?
But
Fantastic Fest is incredible. Well, and it's like great to see you guys there.
Yeah, you see your friends.
You know, it's like it's camp.
It's a homecoming too. Yeah. We see all of our friends. Yeah.
Is that where Greasy Strangler was born? Like with Ant and you guys and Ant Timpson?
Totally. That never would have happened had it not been for, you know, forming relationships with Ant and Tim League at Fantastic Fest.
And one of the key point, I think, one of the reasons that Fantastic Fest is so special is that people aren't there to sell movies.
Yeah.
There's not. I mean, there was the Fantastic Market, which is kind of a totally separate thing. But you're not wheeling and dealing. It's not. There's not agents everywhere. It is genuinely 100%.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the buyers are going there to watch movies.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And that's true. That's a test of the true cool agent or manager.
Totally.
Who's there?
Totally. Yeah.
Just to shoot the shit, hang out, and watch movies.
They're really fans.
You know? Yeah. They're not there because their client has a movie there. It's just because they're fans.
You're so right. Yeah.
And I heard you guys were. This next year, you guys are going to be boxing the guys who made The Other Boy next year. They got the box office, but you're going to let Waller on them and just go to town and turn them into dolls.
But it's that rock that is The Other Boy.
Waller versus Brahms.
Who's on their production staff?
I want to see that show.
See some stats.
But we do want to talk about The Boy because Rob actually shared that one with me. And what did you say? Straight away after you saw it, you said that's an Elric movie.
Yeah, it's an Elric movie. No, well, I mean, it's an Elric movie.
Yeah, I was straight to Art House and the weird, you know, the weird.
We know our specific taste, so we can now like watch movies and be like, that's a Rob. That one's an Elric.
But when he said that, I thought of the other movie. I'm like, I don't know. The twist was all right, but it's stupid doll. And he's telling me how much I'm going to like this movie. And then I realized, oh, there's another The Boy.
Now, to be clear, we both saw both boys.
Yeah, we saw both boys.
We liked them both a lot.
They have the totally different qualities.
Didn't you say you wish they'd make a baby and be
boys? Oh, yeah, I said we need to merge the two. Because the things lacking in one are in the other. And if we do movies, you have the ultimate movie.
Boy.
There you go.
Boy.
The boys.
Supercut.
The boys supercut. Square, yeah.
Somebody out there, please do it.
A fan will
It's just David Morse with a doll, beating up on the doll, putting weird shit on the road. It's a fucking great movie.
Oh, my God. Ryan, you can get them behind this.
I'll work on this,
But yeah, I watched The Boy not knowing anything. I watched Your Boy not knowing anything about it at all and was kind of – I was pretty blown away by it. I mean, it's hard to talk about it without being spoilerish. It's not much of a spoiler, but obviously Psycho is my favorite movie of all time, pretty much.
Wow.
And I did a documentary on Psycho, so I know a lot about it. So as it started to unfold, I was like, oh, whoa, is this like kind of like the prequel story to that horror deal?
Yeah.
But also, I mean – I love that you take an actor like Rainn Wilson. Mm-hmm. I mean, in Cooties, it's what you expect because he's known for that. But I love seeing him in stuff like The Boy.
I didn't even recognize him.
He didn't recognize him halfway through.
Probably never happens to me with actors.
It's awesome. A lot of people have said that they didn't realize it. Well, I also want to point out that I think it's a testament to his performance in Cooties that now in hindsight you're saying, yeah, that was an obvious fit. But what people thought we were nuts when we said we're talking to Rainn Wilson for Wade because he's a jock.
Everyone
thought of him as Dwight, you know. But he's like our De Niro, you know, like we just want to work with him over and over again. He's such a great actor and a very serious guy, very serious. And you know, when we talked about him for The Boy, because that character is very quiet and kind of intense and people go, wow, again, Rainn Wilson. And he's actually pretty similar to that character in life. He's a very quiet, considered he and David Morse
it's the most intimidating thing
very
in the world David standing between Rainn Wilson and David Morse.
They're huge
because they're both like 6'4 6'5
they see right through
giants.
Quiet giants.
I want to do a buddy cop movie with Rainn Wilson and David Morse.
They'll ask you a question, you'll answer, and then they'll just sort of look at you
for like half an hour.
Yeah. You start sweating. Like, if I look away, it means I'm guilty.
But the scale of that movie, there's something really nice about like that, and I think Girl Who Walks Alone, where they're intimate, but they somehow feel
epic. They feel big, but they're just about one person experiences adolescence. And obviously, it wasn't until after I saw the film that I started reading that you guys had planned the idea that the storyline could continue, which is really interesting when you see that character. Well, you know, spoiler, watch the movie. But, you know, when you see that character move on at the end of the movie, you're like, oh, God, where is this going? And we kept talking about Dexter. This is like the pre, you know, felt like a prequel to the show Dexter. What did you, were you pitched initially that this was a bigger story, or is this just something that came through the making of it?
It's actually a great story.
Yeah. It's the only time, I think, ever that we did a film that was sent by an agent or a manager. Usually, you know, the stuff that gets sent to us isn't quite right. But it was there was a short that was in Sundance called Henley, and it was kind of like the first 10 minutes of what ended up being The Boy, the feature. The Gotham group, who are really, really great managers, had sent over the short, and they said, there's a feature script, would you be interested in? And we said, sure. And we read it, and it was kind of a comedy. So we met with the filmmakers, Craig McNeil and Clay McLeod Chapman, and said, we actually pitched them the idea of turning it into a trilogy, because we had been really interested. I got to be careful here, but we were asked to pitch a reboot of Texas Chainsaw Massacre. And our pitch was, we want to track, let's go back a little bit to the Ed Gein story and let's do his childhood. They weren't interested in that idea until they made that film. That's the part I did. Yes. No comment. But we walked away from that, and we'd worked quite hard on like beating out a whole treatment for it and everything. Yeah. And we're like, we really want to do something with this. And then when The Boy came along, it was just the perfect fit. And so we said to them, you know, how would you feel about A, backtracking and playing this more straight, and B, developing it as a trilogy?
Why don't we see the growth of this child into the eventual serial killer he will likely become? I think it also came out of this fascination of the psychology behind serial killers. Yeah. Where does that begin? Is it nature versus nurture? You know, is it inherent in them since the beginning, or is it also as a result of their environment? And that's always been fascinating to me and to all of us. Mm-hmm. And so it was a way for us to sort of explore that in a longer format and really sort of track the growth of someone, both psychologically, but also these sort of mishaps that kind of, if one decision had been made, potentially they'd go a different direction. And it was just really fun to explore that.
So we've plotted out the whole thing, and you know, we did the first one, he's 9, the second one, he's 14, the third one, he's 18.
Would you wait for the actor? Would that be the thinking if you were going
to
do it?
We'd like to,
like a before sunrise.
Yeah. Sunset. Yeah. And Jared is, I mean, you know, I think he certainly has the potential to grow up to be a, you know, Leonardo DiCaprio, or, you know, there's something really special about that kid.
Yeah.
Yeah, it has a lot of heart, too. You guys, a while ago, you were talking about you're looking for characters with heart. And that was the thing about that character. You really care for him. And with the birth of serial killers, if you, you know, you read things about Bundy, they all have this, like, type. And the types usually comes from a major heartbreak, and it's often mother-related.
That's right.
And, you know, with Bundy, I think it was an ex-girlfriend. But it's probably not. It's probably something before that.
Sure.
And I felt like that was the part of the story where I think you really get engaged with what he's going through when you realize he just wants to, you know, he wants to go to Florida
to find his mom. Yeah.
Mom. But then there's something also more sinister and painful under that. And quite menacing, some of those motel scenes with him just standing.
And it's also sad to watch David Morse. He's a father that realizes he doesn't have the capability of being the kind of father he needs to be.
He wants to.
Yeah.
He wants to be a better father.
Doesn't have the skills.
He just doesn't. You see, and David's so beautiful in the movie. He seems struggling to know what to do to help his son.
And he just doesn't.
He just doesn't. He's trying as best he can.
Yeah.
But it's so great. One of the most gratifying things is when you have these ideological conversations about what you want a film to be, and then you make the film and someone says it back to you. And what you just said about how you fear for him, that was a huge, we would constantly reinforce that as we said we want you to both fear him and fear for him at the same time, because he's a kid.
Because it could still go another way at that point, like you're not a serial killer yet. Whereas when we're seeing somebody in full-fledged mode, it's
yeah
and I feel his relationship to that got the beard in the film. His friendship there could actually take him in a good direction.
Totally.
But then he turns on him and falls down. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I went too many see spoilers.
That
yeah.
See that movie?
Okay, a few weeks ago, and this might not even be something, so if this thing you can't talk about, but I literally was thinking to myself, like, why has it been 5 years since Panos Cosmatos made a movie? So I don't know if this is, and then I started looking you guys up today, and I don't know if this is still on the cards, you guys might be working with him, but.
We are
excited, so I wanted to ask if you can say anything. If you can't, besides that, that's fine.
I don't know how much we can
well,
say.
Well, I don't think we should, but
no, but it's
except that he's going to make another movie.
Yeah, and you guys are working with him.
Yeah, this is a good example too of having seen a director's work that we loved and just we literally seeked him out. Like, okay, we want to do whatever it is that you're doing next. Yeah. Do you have another genre film or something in this space? We would love to work with you. And he had this film that, he had this idea. I hate not being able to say anything. But he had this idea that we loved, and he sent us the script, and we fell in love with it. And he's a visionary.
He absolutely is. He's
through and through.
Yeah,
and he reminds me of Lily in that way too. He's got a very singular vision.
And is that why it's been so long in between? You think he's just been trying to work towards
absolutely.
That?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Cool. Very meticulous.
He's patient. Yeah. There's no sense of desperation in him.
to make movies. Without, he wants to make his movie.
No.
Without revealing details, is this one as kind of abstract?
No.
I would say, it's less
abstract. I would say it's even primal.
Wow.
And speaking of primal, the other one that got me excited, I'm just kidding, while you're here, a guest we had on our old show when he was in the country and not living on Frog Mountain, Richard Stanley.
Yes.
And because we're all huge Lovecraft fans, I know you guys, The Color and Space was out there.
Yeah, it's out
and
there. Yeah.
Is that still something you guys and him?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Very much so.
This is good stuff, man. We talk about a click, but this is cool shit. You know?
I am a Lovecraft devotee, and he's... I think perhaps you probably would know. I think he's maybe the most adapted horror author ever, more than King, more than Poe. And yet there's never been a single film that captures Lovecraft. What Stuart Gordon does is incredibly entertaining, but those are Stuart Gordon films. Yeah, yeah. They really resemble Lovecraft. Next to none.
And even ultimately. Some of the Stuart, like the Dreams of a Witch House, I mean, his where he was grasping at Lovecraft in that one kind of, it was still watchable, but it kind of missed the mark on some
comedies,
of the Lovecraft.
Really. Yeah. Yeah. I remember when, Hadrian Belove, he said, hey, I met Richard Stanley, David Gregory, who produced Lost Soul, at a festival, and they came to me and said they have this Lovecraft project and they can't find anybody to get behind it. I said, you had me at Lovecraft. And they sent the script over, and it was like, I think it was like half a page in. I was like, this is it. Somebody finally gets Lovecraft. Mm-hmm. And Richard is honestly one of the most special human beings. People are afraid of him because he's got this reputation for being a wild man, and we've talked about him. Yeah, he is so sweet, and he's
so clear,
and
focused, and he knows what he wants.
He's
and
a mystic.
The way
he's
articulates,
a mystic.
is just extraordinary. Yeah. I look forward to his emails.
His emails, yeah.
Oh, oh amazing.
They're novels. Yeah.
They're
poetry.
So beautiful.
He was one of my favorite guests that we had on our last show. Because,
man, what a treat.
And it was like he was invested in everything he said. Like when we were asking him about his home, you would see him stop and he would compose himself. And then the passion that he just had telling us about his damn house was
like a history
amazing.
Lesson.
Yeah, every single thing he said.
The history of everything from the topic you just mentioned. You're like, man, I can't.
Yeah, and we would be like, so there was a slight voodoo nonsense. Oh, I'm glad you noticed that. And then there would be a half an hour lecture, and I'm just riveted the whole time. Like, do tell more, sir. Yeah. It was just,
what's the
observing, I was going to say observing too, because I remember the first time I interviewed him was on Skype, and he saw the Book of Ebon from the Beyond tattoo, and he goes, that symbol is all over my village, and I was like, wait a second, what? And he's like, yeah, and he gave me like kind of like the real backstory.
Is that actually a real symbol?
It's a symbol like slightly altered, maybe like 10%, like just a little change to it. But he gave me like the whole rundown.
Incredible.
And I was like, wow. But it was just because I had my hand up for 1 second and then went like this. And he's like, wait a minute, let me see that again.
Yeah.
And he just gave me the rundown, and I was like, wait a minute, where are you? Because I realized where he was Skyping from, but then he told me
about the
journey.
He lives in a
castle. And the literally. Journey he had to go to get to a computer to Skype. And he's an unusual but really cool just figure in the genre.
I remember one of our first meetings. I don't think either of you guys were there for some reason.
The first one.
I met him at Le Pan, as usual. And I said, if we do this together, people are going to ask what you've been doing, and I would like you to tell me how to answer that question. And he said, I was searching for the Holy Grail. And I, and then realized that that's actually what he was doing. Yeah. He was searching for the Holy Grail. And it's what I learned with him is just stay with him.
Yeah,
You think he's going off on a tangent, but he's not.
He's like Indiana Jones.
Yeah. He really is.
Yeah. He even dressed a little bit like it this last time.
Presented. Hadrian couldn't get somebody to present. I think it was Four Flies and Grey Velvet, and Hadrian couldn't get somebody to come out to present it. So Richard was in town, so he brought out Richard.
Really?
And Richard came out, and he's like, I'm going to tell you about my Argento story. And he goes into this story about how he was selling pot to Argento. It was the greatest thing. And then it evolved into a very nice love letter to Argento and what he learned from him as a person, how it applied to his filmmaking and all this other stuff.
He's got so many stories that you're like, this has got to be bullshit. And then they're not. I mean, there's a thing about him and Chris Cunningham.
I was just going to mention that.
Go ahead and tell that.
Yeah, well, Chris Cunningham. Do you know Chris Cunningham? Yeah. He started in VFX and he worked with Richard Stanley on two films?
I can't remember what the films were.
Yeah. Dust Devil and
Hardware. Maybe it was.
And Hardware. I believe it was those two.
Those are the only two.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Dust Devil, Hardware, and
way to narrow it down.
Then there's the other one.
It wasn't Moreau.
Good point. Incredible. They were chased by
headhunters or some.
We had a wild story.
Yeah, that again, this can't be true. And then when we met Chris, he told the same story. Richard was telling the truth. But I wish I could. And then there was a thing he talked about, getting there were these stones that bled. And then he took them out and
he gave us the bleeding stone.
Oh, were you there?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. He made the stone bleed. I swear to God, that happened.
And somehow Haiti came up in conversation. Haiti. He's got a deep relationship with Haiti.
Yeah.
Oh, and wild, crazy stories.
You got to listen to
him. You aspire to be that kind of person, you know? It's to me, that's that's a worldly being.
Absolutely.
You know, we pale at our bullshit phones and all that shit.
Totally.
We just pale in comparison.
That's
a man who lives.
Yeah. You know? If you listen to our old show, you learn that every decision that he has made, within the past several decades, he has made based on a British warlock.
The warlock.
Yeah. The warlock.
Oh,
yeah.
God, the warlock.
The British warlock. And he has
that's
name.
That's a big part of the Lost Souls documentary.
Yeah, a big part of the
documentary. When he was going to make the movie, he consulted with the warlock.
Right.
And then when he went to Brando, the warlock, was doing something in England.
That'd
be so cool if the warlock was Alan Moore.
It's just
my favorite warlock.
But I want to ask you about Lovecraft, because I find when people say Lovecraftian nowadays, that just means octopus face or some really generic.
Cthulhu,
but the whole idea when you read is that it's meant to be unimaginable.
Yeah.
And yet somehow we've decided kind of like God being an old man with a white beard. Mm-hmm. That's what it is, and it really puts me off. I think Dagon was one that at least had a lot of other kind of creatures. Yeah. But how is he visualizing? Not spoilers, but is his world of what he wants Lovecraft to be clear and
yes, mm-hmm. yeah. Well, Color Out of Space is a great example of Lovecraft because it's literally about a color that seeps into the atmosphere and starts kind of infecting every living thing.
Curse, that bad movie, it's not a very good movie, The movie The Curse with
Will Wheaton.
Will Wheaton. We just watched it not long ago. It's not great from the 80s, but it is loosely based on.
Oh, right.
And it gets into the vegetables and then the water and it starts affecting, a comet comes down. And it says loosely based on the story.
There are so many Color Out of Space adaptations that I've seen, but they're all incredibly specific. Here's the well. The well is now poisoned. Now everyone's insane. Yeah. Yeah. And that's one thing that I always thought was missing is this kind of otherworldly atmospheric change that happens.
Another visionary
instead of
in
just
a way,
the cow's purple. We probably shouldn't drink the milk. We did. We're all fucked. So,
He has ideas that
are so interesting and innovative.
Very psychedelic.
No kidding.
Very animal.
Kiss the frog.
A thing about the way, the trees, like a moving and...
He's working with artists right now specifically on this.
I love it.
But so he can show other people what he's seeing in his head.
Yeah.
You know, the cinematographer. The DP that he's going to be working with, who's a friend of kind of everybody's, Kareem Hussein. Kareem and Richard have been talking about this project for years. And I think a large part of how it's going to be visualized will be through, you know, experimental types of cinematography that they can blend in with the images, whether that's, you know, mirrors, 3D, you know.
Don't give away the bag of tricks.
How difficult a fund is it to fund a film like that? How hard is it going to be to put together Stanley? So it doesn't really matter.
Every one of them is hard. Yeah. But it gets easier the more movies we make. But tough. And you know, the first thing to overcome with him is just the fears that people in the business have about him because of all the stories about him. And when you know, I remember you and I talked about this, Ryan. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to meet the guy, and you'll see he's saner than we are. That's his problem. It definitely, and also because it's. Lovecraft is so, as you said, it's about intangibles. Mm-hmm. It's hard, but we'll get there.
You seem like the right fit. It makes me excited to see. What are some of the other films that you guys are like? You can talk about that are coming. I saw a poster for Bad Vibes. Mm-hmm. Some other things that are closer to coming out that we might want to hear about.
We're making two films this summer, which I think probably should save for the press releases. We're working on this virtual reality project for Ubisoft, which is extremely exciting. Mm-hmm. I hope we're doing something that you could not do.
If it weren't VR.
What's that?
I think I tested that game.
We're still in development.
Okay. Yeah. I tested one. Never mind.
So Richard Stanley.
I tested one where you were a hedgehog.
Oh, yeah. That has nothing to do with us.
That's a side venture. Suddenly it just reminded me, and I was like, wait, I've done a
this
VR game with Elijah Wood.
When did you turn into a hedgehog,
SpectreVision is a hedgehog.
In the cutest virtual reality game ever. Never mind, we don't have to cut this.
It's really cool, actually. It's Oculus has their own story department, and they're kind of trying to do something like a Pixar studio for Oculus as a means of storytelling, and that was like the first example of how that could be. It's cool.
Yeah, I went to really a tech convention a couple of months ago, and that was one of the things is you get to have a birthday party with this hedgehog, and the hedgehog is Elijah Wood. It's the cutest.
It's very sweet. Yeah. He's got spines. He keeps losing friends.
Aww. It's really sad.
I can assure you that there will be no hedgehogs
in our game.
So the whole virtual reality is like the creation of the chicken nugget? Is that what we're going to just in there with the goop and the...
You are the meat that gets processed and gets shot upon by a fly.
How do you even start? Like, what's the point of origin when you're dealing with virtual reality? What's the starting point? Hiring technologists, or are you guys working on stories and ideas? And then how do you even? Yeah, it's creative.
Yeah. I mean, we're working with a team at Ubisoft. So in terms of the technical aspects, they're handling all of that. It was really just coming to them with as many ideas as we could, and brainstorming, and sitting in a conference room much like this. Just like spitballing, and you know, some of them were more fully formed. Some of them were literally just like concepts or tones, the things that we wanted to feel. And then we kind of whittled that down just to this thing that we are now working on. And it's so exciting. It's a completely new creative process. Mm-hmm. We're all super engaged in it. We have a sort of head of digital called Kyle McCullough, who's very much a gamer and is, you know, a huge part of this as well. So it's just fun. It's really fun I'm a big gamer myself, so to be involved with this company whom I have admiration for in the creation of something in this VR space and to be playing with the medium in an interesting way is awesome. It's really gratifying.
Now, I've gotten really into VR games recently, largely after I went to that convention where I got to test out the hedgehog one. But is creating scares in a VR space different than kind of creating the scares in a film world? Like, how do you
Good
kind of approach
question.
Them differently?
It should be, in my opinion.
Yeah, in the sense that you can't control where people look.
Right.
Scares can't be timed in the same way that they are in films.
Have you guys played the demo for Sisters yet?
I have not.
I highly
There's a number of horror games that I've not even tried, so I'm super keen to try all that stuff.
Yeah, Sisters, I highly recommend it.
Right? Mm-hmm. No. Have you played it?
When it comes to
someone called it the scariest game of all time.
That's what I heard. I saw reaction videos, you know. And we've been, we've kind of been taught exploring the VR space, and just so that like puts me on the front lines of all the festivals when we're at Sundance and all that stuff. But admittedly, Paranormal Activity was the one that I got introduced to at Sundance because it's mostly Paramount stuff, you know, and Paramount handles that property a lot. But I haven't tried it. But I saw a little demo. It looked like the fun. But there was one that I did. What was the Stanley one that we were all like going bonkers on? No, Wheelchair.
Oh, yeah.
We were all losing our minds.
What is it called?
I can't remember.
Catatonic. We tried that at Stanley, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Super fun.
Yeah, yeah. We had. It was funny because I brought him in here. And he set up the wheelchair right over there in the corner. And then we had everybody lined up down the hallway to try it out.
Oh, what fun.
And Joel Edgerton was cutting the gift. And he's like, what's all this about? And he came in. We sat him down. All of a sudden, he's just sitting in the chair screaming, you know.
He put the headset on.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. What was the thing that you said?
Sisters, Ryan, I'm doing this next week. I'm bringing you my little box so that you can try out Sisters. It's only a demo.
Can you rattle my chair while you're
doing it? I don't need to. It's scary. I'm going to record it for the site. Great, it freaked me out so bad. Yeah.
Oh, that
it's
sounds
good.
Awesome.
There's a crazy poster on your site next to Bad Boy, Curse the Darkness. I didn't know anything about that. Is that one that's already in the can, or is this thing that's still being worked on?
It's still in development.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Cool poster, though.
We tend to talk to everybody about this because obviously we're always searching for new films and recommendations and things like that. But what lately in the genre has excited you guys just as fans? Not obviously all your films are the ones that you want people to see, but in the last couple of years, it's obviously It Follows is one that everybody talked about and stuff like that. But is it some of the independent horror stuff that's really stood out and been among your favorites?
I gotta say, Creesha. Which is not a genre film, but it might as well be.
What?
Hold on. Played at CineFamily a few weeks ago, just once. Yeah, played. Yeah, had one. Yeah, had a one screening.
Oh,
with the woman's face. Yeah.
Has no one here seen it?
I still haven't seen it.
I can't even figure out how to spell this.
K-R-I-S-T.
I'm really surprised.
K-R-I-S-T.
I only heard about it from that. I saw that they're having one. It might have been a special engagement. It was a one screen.
Well, A24 is putting it out. Uh-huh. It's difficult to describe. It's this guy made a movie with his actual family, all playing themselves. But it's a work of fiction. Mm-hmm. And the whole thing's in one house, and it's kind of like with Lily Armbrapor. You're just like, I saw this movie. It was just like, this guy is like, he's going to be making movies for a long, long time. But from last year, Victoria is a film that I think all three of us were just
completely
obsessed with. I saw it three times in the theater. Yeah, it's I love that film so much.
And this is the film conceptualizes a one take. But the boring one take that just follows you walking. This is it's caught up in action and cars. It looks really amazing.
But you forget about the one take after a while. It has so much more to offer than that. And it's not a gimmick. I really love was trying to champion because we programmed it at SpectreFest. It's a movie called Tikkun. TIKKUN. Have you seen it, Ryan?
Keep going.
The Hasidic film.
It's an Israeli film set in the Hasidic community. It's a horror film. And it's a knockout. Mm-hmm. It's like a 5-star masterpiece.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow.
And when's that going to be coming out? Do you know?
Never.
Nothing.
No, I see
it. It's challenging. It's a challenging movie.
You did see it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I still don't know. I'm still processing it all,
Sure. It helps if a bit about the Hasidic culture. It's about a kid who masturbates, which is forbidden, and what happens to him after he.
I would harbor to say that Son of Saul is almost a horror
interesting
film.
Yeah.
Have you seen Son of Saul?
Yes.
Horrifying.
Yes.
Horrifying and a completely singular experience.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the camera is literally either behind his head or in front or on the side. The entire film, and it's set at a concentration camp, so you're literally seeing the atrocities, but they're all happening in soft focus, which is far more terrifying. And you, as a sort of viewer, as you're sort of with this main character, you feel like you're in it. It's a very difficult,
best farm, right? This year, yeah, best farm.
It's a very difficult experience.
I think that just hit Netflix too, so I got to see it. Oh, I've been
And also,
I think it just did.
Yeah. The Witch, y'all.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't understand why it's polarizing. Like, I don't either.
It's one of those few movies where, like, it follows. I loved, but I kind of got one.
No, here's my thing. We're now a very hypersensitive culture when it comes to opinions, thanks to the internet. So when someone goes, you know what? I don't like The Witch. You're like, whoa! You know what? Fuck you, man! Like, how can? But I was going through an old Cinefantastique. It was like issue number 3. Exorcist had just come out, and it was a compilation of all the reviews.
Wow.
Yeah. And there were so much negativity. Really? It's ridiculous.
Well, think about The Thing.
But I mean, like, yeah. But it's
the
just like
visceral reactions to those movies.
But what shocked me, a couple of weeks ago, Ryan and I did a panel together at Monsterpalooza, and that was one of the first questions that he asked was, okay, guys, let's talk about the polarization of The Witch and why some people thought that it was great and others didn't. Why was it so bifurcating? And
Look at it. She wrote it down in bold
words.
Sorry, in the movie, you assholes. Bifurcating to assholes. Same sentence. Anyways, what was I? Oh, yeah. Sorry. The Witch. So we were talking about why it, you know, had such a derisive nature within the audience, where some people loved it and some people hated it. And Ryan was like, okay, guys, so is it horror? And these people from the audience were like, no. And then Ryan was like, well, what is it? And somebody goes, historical. It's a period movie. And then we were like, can horror not be period?
Well, this is what I said. I was like, well, it could still be horror.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I mean, like, rabbit.
Make American horror films great again. That's historical. We don't need that shit.
But then that kind of got me thinking, have we almost kind of put ourselves into a corner? Horror film is a contemporary ghost story, because now, like, I notice every single time I talk about Old Boy on the site, there's somebody there to go, Old Boy's not a horror film. Mm. Well, it scares the fuck out of me, so I'm putting it up there. But it seems like...
Expand the definition, yeah.
Yeah, we've gotten very kind of...
But The Witch... Well, tell us what you think about The Witch.
What's interesting about that, though, is... whilst that somehow happened in the audience in terms of the conversation about that movie and Babadook and It Follows, less so with those, much more with The Witch, which I find very strange, I don't think that that's representative of what's happening in the landscape. You know what I'm saying? Like, these movies are being made, and there are more like this being made. So I feel like the landscape of cinema is just fine.
Yeah.
It's the audience that needs to come around to accepting that these are a part of what they define horror to be.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
I
feel like with The Witch specifically, this is my theory anyway, because I saw friends of ours at Fantastic Fest walk out of that movie and go, I don't know, didn't really do it for me. And I grilled a few of them, and I was like, what are you talking about? This is one of the most incredible horror movies in the last 10 years. What is it that didn't work for you?
Yeah.
And I think it was expectations. And I think somehow The Witch out of Sundance rose to this meteoric place in people's minds as it was the scariest movie ever made and scarier than The Exorcist and all these things that set up really undue expectations about this movie. It's a quiet, uncomfortable... You know,
sad.
Slow
it's quite
burn,
sad. Sad. It's about the end of a family. It's
unsettling film. Yeah. It is never, ever going to explode in a violent way, and I think people expected it to. That's definitely part of it.
But what about the part when people say it's not horror? Like, that's the part my mind goes, wait a minute, it's got the devil, a dark lord himself. It's got witches, actual witches, not just talking about witches. Yeah. Like, where is this not?
And I'm curious what you is that I think that was the result of it going wide.
I think that's wild.
And It Follows, that could be the case for It Follows.
That was the point that maybe because on the panel you guys were on, it was Mike Flanagan had said, It's like if it's audience perception. If it's a little indie movie that gets in all these theaters, because it's everyone's like, oh, wasn't that scary? You know, like they kind of like to knock down the little one that gets the chance.
Yeah.
And then the big movie that gets the chance are like, oh, this is great. Like I can't remember
what happened with Oculus.
Yeah.
I remember hearing at the festival circuit that movie, the buzz was incredible. And then as soon as it hit theaters, the buzz completely just
was different. I mean, like it goes part and parcel with, I think, you know, just the exposure to opinions. Yeah. You know, I mean, like back in the 80s. You know, when my dad was a horror fan, he would go, oh, it's a new John Carpenter movie. Great. Can't wait to see it. And he would just go in completely clean. You know, however, if it was internet days back in 1982, 81, 82, you know, and everybody's talking about, oh, The Thing. Oh, what a disappointment. John Carpenter. What happened? Right. This movie is disgusting. You're if you were, like, applied the criticism that The Thing got, which was, it's grotesque, it's disgusting, the effects are over the top, and how dare John trade in subtlety for this kind of stuff, you know?
It's
nothing,
and it's like the original.
It's nothing or nothing like the original, because you still had audience members who remember going to see The Thing from Another World when they were a kid, you know? People would probably go in with different perceptions, but
I think we do it just as much as everybody else.
Huh?
I think we do it too. I mean, everybody does.
Yeah. I try to be a little bit more blinders up. You know, there's like a select group of people. Like today, you know, I hit up one of our mutual friends and was like, hey, you see this movie? And he's like, yep. And I'm like, what'd you think? And he's like, eh. And I'm like, okay.
But fair I guarantee.
That's I'm listening to you, you know.
I would guarantee that you were still sitting in the Elm Street remake going, okay, impress me.
Oh, totally. The thing now is, and this is maybe for you too, like going into scripts, you know, you kind of go in being hopeful that it's going to be good. And you look, you're seeing a lot of the negative reading it. You're like, oh, they really messed that up. But you're going to latch on to what's exciting.
Sure.
You know, latch on to those parts of the script or the movie that, like, excites you. And then you kind of weigh how much of that's there versus what's negative, you know? And Nightmare on Elm Street, I just couldn't.
That's also relatively specific,
you know, because those are things that are dear to our heart. And it's really we as horror fans are subjected to that, it feels like, more than any other genre in regards to taking something so precious and fucking, like, driving it into the ground.
Yeah.
Thanks, Platinum Dunes.
Take this moment.
I mean, in the most lovingly way possible, our partners on The Purge and We Do.
Absolutely. Did that not make us love you guys?
While Green Room is still in theaters, I want people to try to see it in theaters.
Please. Yes, please.
Because it's the best thing I've seen on a screen this year.
Absolutely.
Chewed my fingernails down to the bone.
That was one of my favorite films at Fantastic Fest.
And I think seeing it in the theater is so rich, you know? Movies like that.
It's a visceral experience, man.
But, like, when I read, you know, that he's attached to some spy movie at Warner Brothers, I'm like, oh, I want, like, I just want one more Green Room out of him. I want one more, like...
He will. I mean, he's got this film that Macon's written. I think it's an adaptation of a book.
Okay, yeah.
So that's in development. Cool. I think they announced that a while ago.
Yeah.
So that is a guy I do not fear. He will always do his own thing.
Totally. He did a great conversation with to Pimp Another podcast, the Nerdist Writers panel podcast. And he had a great conversation with the interviewer on that one, and he was very open and honest talking about the making of Green Room and how much he was kind of butting heads. And I think someone asked him, they were like, how much was Green Room ultimately? And he's like, I have no idea. And that's where the problem began. Yeah. He's like, I have no idea how much my movie cost, because we started here and then it just spiraled out of control. And I was like, holy crap. But
I'd love to listen to that.
Yeah, you should. It's good. I mean, like, he talks a lot about his creative process and all that stuff, but it's really early on. The conversation is pretty interesting.
That's cool.
Yeah.
So there's yet another great Macon Blair performance.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
So SpectreFest is going to happen again this year?
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Okay, excellent. Cool.
And the entire lineup is?
Don't know.
Nice try. And the title of Panos' movie as well. All right, I give up. That's it.
A box of secrets.
Well, just final question in terms of, you know, looking ahead and at the future SpectreVision. What's exciting? Obviously the elements that are being presented are exciting. VR, the new films, but for you
T-shirts
guys,
on your website. That's usually a sign that you guys have gotten
merchandise.
Got merchandise. I saw that. That's
iPhone skin covers. Yeah. But for you, what you know, looking at the future, what's getting you guys personally exciting in terms of either, you know,
on the landscape?
Yeah. Or no, just in the company. Yeah, for you guys. Yeah.
I don't know that we've
think that way. I think, you know, but what immediately excited. Came to mind to me is just the individual films. And I hope we'll always work that way. Yeah. You know, it's just about, like, we want to make – this should exist. We want this to exist.
Yeah. I think, yeah, and I think, a continued sense of community. I think that that's something that we've – that is a part of the horror genre and the sort of world that we're all in. Mm-hmm. The sort of support of all of the filmmakers and other artists in that realm, which I think is very much a part of our existence as well. And we're inspired by that. We're inspired by other producers. We're inspired by their filmmakers and other companies. And I think – and want to champion the success of those people. And I don't know another – I don't know another section of the film industry that feels as supportive as this. And that's a huge part of what drives us too, and excites us. Sure.
And risk taking. I mean, I even saw on your website that not to say everyone should be flooding you with submissions, but you guys are trying to create a bit more of a dialogue to the world in terms of looking for materials, not just coming from your friends.
Right? Yeah, well, and we're pretty unusual in that way. And I should say, at the moment, our open submissions is temporarily closed.
Closed it for a second.
Instead, just tweet it at them. Especially Elijah, tweet all scripts right to Elijah.
1 million just. Yeah. Or if you have snail mail, his address is 174. A movie that we're literally closing the deal now, and we'll be announcing it soon. We're getting ready to make a film that was submitted to us through Facebook. This was before we officially had the open.
I really love that.
And we read the log line and we're like, sounds interesting. Sure, we'll read it, and we're just blown away. And remember, I still remember calling him and saying we'd like to work with you, and just hearing the joy in his voice, that kind of stuff. I think, just speaking personally, having struggled so long, to get to the point where I'm actually making movies for a living and having very rarely encountered people that were not just transactionally driven, to be able to do this for this filmmaker is more rewarding than any, windfall of cash or anything.
Oh, and that feeling of sitting at Sundance for the first screening of Girl Walks Home Alone at night the comic book, the first issue of the comic book is handed out to everybody. The amount of pride at seeing that thing come together for her, and the fact that all these people were there to see something that she had created that was so stunning, is that not, doesn't get better than that. It's such a good feeling.
Yeah, no, that's exciting. And it really shows in the kind of films you guys are putting out. They're just so different from each other, even within each other. Is Greasy Strangler coming out this year?
Yeah,
it is, yeah.
We'll see it.
Is it October?
Okay.
Yeah, October.
And we get those beanies with the pink, right? I mean, that was genius.
That was all Tim League.
There have been more beanies made, I think. He brought some to the San Francisco screening.
We're selling them eventually.
There you go, Elric. You got to buy one.
I'm getting out.
There's tennis and guys. We're wearing our beanies to the screen. Yeah, that
needs to be on the SpectreVision site. Got to sell some of those. Well, people who don't know, it's like the Grease logo, but done greasy.
Right? Yeah, on a bright pink ski cap. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was so fun walking down the street, Main Street in Park City, seeing people with these pink.
Some of the most random people wearing it.
So weird. Ridiculous. So weird.
Yeah. And I forget who it was. Maybe it was Molly Elfman. It was like, I just got offered $100 for my. yes.
You guys are selling them on eBay, aren't you, right now?
That's how we're funding the kids' film.
The next film coming up.
Well, it's really awesome that you guys, you talk about building a community, and that's how we've always viewed our show, where it's a conversation with the listeners and about people who are just equally passionate. Sure. So I think the fact that you guys are willing to come in here for a couple hours and discuss it like this is says a lot about what you're doing.
Thank you.
We really appreciate it.
And fingers crossed the Lovecraft film happens.
Bring Richard Stanley back.
We agree. Yeah. Guys, thanks so much. It's been really
fun. Thank you, Elijah, Josh, Daniel. Thank you, Ryan, for sitting in on this episode. Yeah.
Thank you, Ryan.
Special thanks to Andrew Furtado, who recorded the last two.
Thanks, Andrew.
Thank you so much.
Also edited the director's cut of Nightbreed.
Cut of Nightbreed. Yes, he did.
What?
So there you go.
That's awesome. We showed the world premiere of that film at SpectreFest.
Yeah.
Yeah, the director's cut.
Now the next 2-hour episode. All right, thanks, guys.
Thank you so much. We'll see you next week.
Thank you.